Welcome, everyone, to the Islanders Never Say Die podcast. I'm your host, TJ, and with me here, as always, is our NHL analyst and expert, the grumpy old man. They say there's no shame in his game because he's always the same.
That's me.
Grumpy, how are you doing this fine Wednesday evening?
Pretty good, thank you. How about yourself?
Oh, not bad, not bad. We just happened to stir up the social media Twitter sphere, I guess, yesterday. You gotta love it.
Though. I don't know why you do that.
It's kind of fun. It's kind of fun.
What do you think your name is? Phil?
Kind of. That's where I get my inspiration from, Grumpy, to mess with on Twitter. But for those of you who are new to the show, welcome. This is a twice a week All Islanders podcast that takes place every single Wednesday, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, and every single Saturday at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. So if you're new to the channel, we invite you to stick around a while. We invite you to subscribe on YouTube, to like on Facebook, and to follow on Twitter. We also have a second podcast called TJ and the Grumpy Old Man. It is a twice a week all sports podcast where myself, Grumpy, and Son X talk anything and everything sports. We talk NFL, we talk NHL, NBA, MLB, we talk world football, we talk any college athletics, we talk literally anything and everything sports on that.
Fan fights.
Here's the thing, we got to be careful with fan fights because we showed one fan fight and again, our damn video got age restricted, Grumpy. So we've got to be careful. They don't like us showing fan fights, Grumpy, even though they are literally a fan favorite. Fan fights, a fan favorite. I feel like I'm saying literally.
Maybe it's other things like your constant using of the word F. That is maybe the reason why we've been.
They give us the highlighted section, which age restricts it, and it's always the fighting. They don't like to see the fighting stuff at age.
What's wrong with these people?
They don't like it. Whatever. But anyway, it's a twice a week all sports podcast. We talk anything and everything sports with myself, Grumpy, and Son X on Thursdays at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. So that's tomorrow. And on Sundays at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. You can find that either A in the link in the description below or as a feature page here on our YouTube channel.
I see it. I'm excited. My name's a little small, but hey, I've grown to accept it.
You finally have gotten over, Grumpy? You're finally willing to accept the small name?
Not really.
Here I once had hope. Oh, well. But, Grumpy, we had a little trade that occurred yesterday for the New York. There's been a lot of trades already before the NHL trade deadline. I cannot remember a time in recent history to where I would say about 70% of all the trades have probably already been made before the trade deadline actually takes place.
I'm going to bet more than that. Everything now is just going to be little ancillary moves. There's nobody left, really.
Yeah.
I mean, I was surprised with some of the names that got moved and what they got, to be honest with you. I looked at teams
The trade deadlines for those unaffiliated is this Friday at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Most times there's a lot of trades that happen on that day or maybe the night before, but there's a lot of trades that have been getting done a week in advance.
I think it's going to be anticlimactic on Friday afternoon. Very anticlimactic.
It's going to be disappointing for certain. I think you're right there. I think it's going to be disappointing for sure, Grumpy. But, you know, the big one, obviously, that we're going to talk about, because we'll kind of break down the trades that have all taken place. But the big one, obviously, that we're going to talk about, the one that affected the New York Islanders. The New York Islanders, Grumpy, they didn't sell their hands.
I don't think that's a big
deal. Hold on. We're going to talk about the one that affected our boys, the New York Islanders. That's what we're going to talk about, Grumpy. And there was a trade out there that the New York Islanders made. If I recall, Grumpy, last week you said there were going to be no more trades by Lou Lamoriello.
I said no.
He shot his load. No. This is, I'm paraphrasing you almost exactly to the T. No trades by Lou Lamoriello coming up.
I believe what I said was there might be some ancillary move that means nothing.
Shit, you said nothing. I told you on that show, Grumpy, that they were not going to trade for big name guy, but they're going to give up second and third round picks for players of very little consequence. And that's what has happened.
That's what I said.
Bullshit. Go look back through the tape. Don't try to lie. Yeah, you were swearing up and down no other moves were going to get made. Look at his ass. Now he's trying to go ahead and backpedal over here like freaking, like damn, like Michael Jackson over here. Come on, Grump.
I said we had nothing to move that's worth anything. And certainly what we picked up wasn't worth anything.
We were told by you, Grumpy, that, hey, picks next year's draft don't matter. They don't value picks like that. But it was crazy. We gave up something with no value, apparently. A second round pick.
What I said was, to clarify, I said that trading next year's first round pick means nothing because it's not going to be able to get us anyone of value who's going to help the team long term. That's what I said. You might see an ancillary piece added. That's what I said. And I would think that Pierre Engvall absolutely falls in that category. Bottom six forward, whoop-de-doo. Don't we have enough of those already? I guess not. The Maple Leafs had to move him, and they figured, well, let's see. He's not worth anything with these guys we just picked up from Chicago. Let's contact Lou Lamoriello. He'll overpay for a guy who's really not that good. And Lou acquiesced and said, sure, whatever.
I'll tell you this, Robbie. I don't hate Engvall as a player, right? That's not the thing. I think he serves an important role. I think he could be a valuable player.
It's a meh move.
What I don't like, Grumpy, is the fact that you're right. We're not winning a Stanley Cup this year. And here we are trading away a third round pick in next year's draft for a guy that was going to be available for every single team to sign come July 1st. We felt so adamant. And here's the thing. We don't even know if we're going to sign him back. I assume we'll sign him back based off of what we gave up, a third round pick for a bottom six guy. But that's not the team's actual needs. The team needs top end talent and guys who could score. You see sometimes Tampa, right? Oh, Tampa makes a trade, not necessarily a big name guy, and they give up a first round pick for him, a guy who's going to be playing in their bottom six. Well, Tampa does not need any scoring touch. Tampa has first ballot Hall of Fame guys like Steven Stamkos. They've got offensive powerhouses like Kucherov, like Braden Point. They have the scoring without an issue. Tampa needs more of the systematic player that's going to be a glue piece that helps them win games.
Role player.
The Islanders, on the other hand, need the ability to score. We are 24? I think now we're 24th in the NHL in goals scored per game, average goals scored per game. It's not good. The biggest issue that we've had on this team for years, as you've mentioned over and over again, our inability to score.
Yeah. I mean, we do have some injuries right now. Matty B's out.
Yeah.
Pageau is out. I mean, but still, it's not like we're phenomenal as a goal scoring team. We haven't been for years and years.
Yeah. I mean, like you look at, we've played well, Grumpy, without Matt Barzal, shockingly enough. We've played a different system without Matt Barzal, I'd say. And I was talking about that yesterday on a Twitter space. We've been playing different style of hockey without Matt Barzal. I couldn't tell you as to what the reasoning is behind it. I mean, like the last few games, we've happened to play, you know, more of a buttoned-up system. We've been happening to be more defensive-focused. We have not been generating as many chances. Yesterday, we did generate chances. The first and the third period, I thought we were the dominant team. Last night against the Wild. That second period, I thought the Wild took it to us. But the first and the third period, I thought that the Islanders outplayed the Minnesota Wild.
I thought the first period was back and forth. I did. I thought the Wild came out playing better in the second. I thought we played better in the third, the majority of the third. Their goaltender, Gustafson, had a good game.
Fantastic game.
I mean, Sorokin made a couple of big saves, too. Everything was not clean, but he was making the saves. I mean, you lose 2-1 in a shootout, you know, whatever. That game was played. I mean, if the NHL was played like that throughout the league, they'd have no fans. That was a boring game to watch. Minnesota plays the same style, right? I mean, let's just limit people moving through the neutral zone, blah, blah. I mean, just like, oh, yawn, yawn. When's it going to be over? I mean, there was no excitement of that game. And I'm not saying necessarily from the Islanders' end, but Minnesota also just sucked the life out of the game too. And I think the Islanders were content to play the same way. They were happy they got the point, hoping they were going to get two. That's a thing for the Islanders. For me, the next week and a half, this is going to tell you if we're going to make the playoffs, these next four games. Right? You got Detroit, Buffalo, Pittsburgh, Washington. Washington's out of the race. You can see some of the moves they've made. They've said, you know what? No, we're not going anywhere this year. Let's, retool for the future. You're seeing that with some of the moves they've made. And I've been happy with, if I was a Washington fan, I'd be happy with some of the moves that they made, honestly. But for the Islanders, have to beat Detroit, have to beat Buffalo, have to beat Pittsburgh. And then if we beat Washington, if we win those four games, I guarantee you we're going to make the playoffs.
Okay. I don't know why the fuck you've taken it to this point, because we haven't even really talked yet about the trade much. But Grumpy takes shit where he likes to go.
Okay. We picked up a bottom six winger.
Okay. Well, hold on, Grumpy. It continues to build on what I don't think we're done yet, buddy. I don't think we're done yet. That's my point.
Who's available? Right?
Okay. Wait, please. I got to respond back because you jumped the gun, as per the usual Grumpy likes to do. I think the next four games are important. You know, I don't want to minimize that. You've got Detroit. I think we beat Detroit. I think Detroit, they don't have what it takes yet. They're a young team. They have a lot of room for improvement. They're a team that, you know, they traded Hornick today. You know, so that's a team that they would benefit from bringing in another old veteran to help teach the young guys what it's like to win and what it's like to take that transition. I like Stevie Y. I think he's going to bring them in the right direction. I've got no issue at all on that. But you're right. I mean, like, you know, Hornick was traded away and they got a first round pick
and
a second round pick for Philip Hornick. I like Philip Hornick. Here's the thing. They gave up a Philip Hornick and a fourth round pick for a 2023 first round pick, Vancouver Canucks 2023 first round pick.
Which is our pick. It's our conditional pick. That's the pick they're going to get. So they're going to get a pick in the top, you know, 16 of the draft. They're going to get that. Mm. I mean, I thought that was interesting. I'm like, boy, oh boy. So they have something like, I think 9 picks, 5 in the first 2 rounds, I believe this year, and 9 picks in the total draft. That's pretty good for Detroit.
Yeah, I think Detroit knows what they're doing. They do have a lot of young players, a lot of prospects. They need to start transitioning and adding some aged individuals who are veterans that know what it takes to be a consistent NHLer. So they need to start transitioning that way. I like what Washington has been doing, right? You know, they've been selling off pieces on expiring deals. They've been getting back picks. They're going to be able to restock the cupboards, and they're going to say, hey, let's assess what needs to be done this offseason. They still have guys that are of value under contract. You know, they were able to admit, hey, we're probably not going to be able to beat teams like Boston. We're probably not going to be able to win a Stanley Cup. And, you know, they started that transition phase. How far behind are the Islanders? Again, I thought the Islanders should have already taken place, but we haven't. But, you know, I kind of want to talk about the next four games are important. The Detroit Red Wings, I think we beat them. The Buffalo Sabres, I think we lose to. I think we lose to the Penguins. We beat the Penguins. I thought we were going to lose to the Penguins at least once when we played them earlier. But, I mean, Casey DeSmith and Jari were both miserable, and we beat the Penguins.
Have they picked up a goalie since that last time we played them?
No.
Then we're not beating them because their goaltending is just a disgrace. Mm. I can't see us losing to Pittsburgh. They outplay us every game, and their goaltending is so bad that it doesn't matter. It just doesn't matter.
Doesn't even matter. That little song, Grumpy. But I mean, there's a lot that's happened since we went on Saturday. I mean, think about it. You also have damn Timo Meier. I think that broke. Was that Sunday evening? Yep. Timo Meier was traded to the Devils, right?
Big move for the Devils.
Huge trade.
And they didn't have to trade away any of their young players to get him.
Not true. Are you talking about young NHL, on the roster NHLers?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. That's okay, sure. But I mean, like, you look at some of these players that are in this trade that went back the other way. I know Shakir, he was a first round pick, I think, in 2020. Zetterlin, I think, was a second round pick. I'm just looking over a 2023 first round pick, a 2024 second round pick. I mean, they got the better player in that deal for certain. They did, and you know, they're going to get some draft, or you know, you're going to get some draft picks there for the Sharks. But right, this is another one of these teams that are in our division that are continuing to take steps in the right direction and fortify that team and their team.
And the Devils don't need to get younger. They have the youngest team in the league. Correct. The fact that they didn't have to get rid of anybody off their roster on a team that's really performed this year, that's a win for the Devils, in my opinion. All right, you gave up a couple of guys who were, you know, previous draft picks. You got the best player in the deal. And Scott Harrington, who's also a solid veteran defenseman type. That's who they got. I think that's a great deal for the Devils. I really do.
So teams around, and that's not a rental piece, right? That's a piece, right? That's going to be there long term. You hate to see that, as the Islanders, you certainly do. Yeah, Tanner Janot, Tanner Jeannot. Is it Jeannot or Jeannot? Can never remember.
Jeannot.
I mean, like, yep, he goes there. You know, he's acquired. Cal Foote's on the way out. A 2025 first round pick, a 2024 second round pick, a third, a fourth, and fifth round pick in this year's draft.
Okay.
Lightning, I feel like, always overpay every single trade deadline, but it works out for them because they know the piece they need.
And I think they overpaid here as well. But those guys always seem to work out for them for whatever reason they do. And he's young. So, and he's something that they can use that their team lacks a little bit of, right? It's not, you're right. It's not, the goal scoring top line winger. It's not that. It's, you know, the nuts and bolts guys. And he's certainly one of those.
Yeah. The Maple Leafs were not quiet either, Grumpy. The Maple Leafs were making some moves at this year's trade deadline. And not even to mention, too, right? I mean, the freaking Rangers acquire Patrick Kane as well. Right. And it was a second round pick. But if they make it to the Eastern Conference Finals, it becomes a first round pick. I mean, like the Rangers, I think they definitely need to add defensive pieces, but they've gone out there and they've added real snipers to that team and guys like Vladimir Tarasenko and guys like Patrick Kane. You know, it's going to be how does it mesh and work together? Because you look at it on paper, you're looking at those names and you say, wow, that is a team that has a very vaunted offense.
Is there any team in the NHL who has the firepower that the Rangers have now?
I don't think so.
I don't think so either. They're top two lines. And here's the thing. You could do the Josh Bailey spread the suck around and have three really good lines. God. I mean, maybe they drop Kane down, play him potentially down on the third line. I mean, think about it. You could have three really good scoring lines. I mean, I like what the Rangers have done. They're all in too, right? And they had to give up, for me, virtually nothing to get Kane. A second-round pick could be a first. And wouldn't you make that trade-off? You're getting, I guess, to the Eastern Conference Finals or the Stanley Cup Finals, and then you give up your first-round pick. Other than that, it's a second and a fourth for Patrick Kane. Yeah, he's been dinged up a little bit, but he's been really good the last month.
When you are on a team that's winning games, you don't feel the bumps and bruises as bad as when you're on a team that consistently loses. That's just the sad truth of it. I don't think they gave up a lot to get a guy who, you know, in all essence is a rental, who has elite talent, right? Nobody's doubting the elite talent of Patrick Kane. So, I mean, that's a big signing. It's a big trade by the Rangers.
And you look at part of this deal also is Arizona is picking up some money. Arizona has 27 picks in the first five rounds of the next three drafts. Think about that. I mean, they're a team that, if they're smart, can turn that team around in 3 years with all young talent.
Last night, too, Jonathan Quick was traded for a conditional first round pick in the 2023 NHL draft and a third round pick in 2024 NHL draft. And they got Vladislav Gark, I'm going to mispronounce
Gavrikov.
Gavrikov and Korpisalo.
You want to Korpisalo.
Korpisalo there, Grumpy. It's Jonathan Quick he's finished. Is what it is. You know, father time is undefeated. And Korpisalo, I don't think Korpisalo is that fantastic. So, you know, it's a better goalie option than they currently had. But like you're looking at all of these trades, this has all happened. Within, you know, look at the times on these.
Last 2 days.
Even let's take the clock back to February 26th because you still have quite a few trades. I mean, that's when Timo Meier took place. I mean, Jack John, look at all the trades that have happened dating back to February 26th. Quite a few. And then 25th, I guess, even Nino Niederreiter, Kratzoff on the move. There's been a lot of trades here in the last 4 or 5 days.
Yep. And you look at the teams who I think done very well. Well, we can look at the Hurricanes. Jesse Puljujarvi traded for unsigned draft pick, which, you know, Hurricanes were not going to sign him. Maybe Puljujarvi's a guy who needed a change of scenery.
He is. He played when he remember when he played with McDavid, when he played on that top line, he was putting up points in droves. Anybody's going to put up points with McDavid. It's as simple as that. But he has been a guy that struggled, had ups and downs. He's still young, 24 years old. And, you know, that guy, I think he was like the ex-fourth overall pick back in the draft. Doesn't mean that you're going to always, you know, correlate to being a successful NHLer. But that's a guy who could very easily just have gotten lost in the shuffle of things because there's so many talented forwards on that team in Edmonton that he just doesn't crack the top portion. But maybe with a different opportunity, he'll play better.
Right. And I think that, you know, you listen to, you know, the pundits and like, I always think that Lou Lamoriello gets way too much credit based on things that he did 30 years ago. Well, I think that the Hurricanes get a whole lot of credit for the things that we mentioned that I still don't understand that seem to work out for them. So they, oh, this has got to be a great trade for them because they made it. I just think this is an ancillary move as well. Yeah, maybe he could turn out
to be something. I like the move for them. I think it was a low, I mean, like, I thought it was
low risk, high reward type thing.
Exactly. A low risk, high reward. I couldn't even tell you who the hell this kid is, but Patrick, I'll pull him up here. I couldn't even tell you who the hell he is or what he does or where he was drafted. No information on this before. Third round pick back in 2019. He's put up a few points there in the Finnish Elite League. So, you know, but it's
nowhere close to playing in the NHL.
Yeah, he's 22 years old, still playing in Finland, I believe. So, you know, is what it is on that side. But, you know, we keep scrolling through. I mean, the amount of trades that have been made, like Marcus Johansson. Hey, they're transitioning away. See you later, Marcus Johansson. We're going to pick up a third-round pick in next year's draft for you.
This is the, right here. This is the deal that I thought was really good. Not that one. Next one for Washington right here. Washington acquires defenseman Rasmus Sandin from Toronto in exchange for Eric Gustafson and a first-round pick in 2023. So in essence, they want to trade Gustafson. For me, is not that great on the back end. We're all familiar with them. But they moved Orlov, who was 32 years old, going to be an unrestricted free agent, for Rasmus Sandin, who was looked at in Toronto earlier this year as a sure fire top four guy in their defense corps. And then some other guys tended to have played a lot better and maybe have cheaper deals. And so he was kind of the odd man out with the other guys that Toronto added. They added Shen, and I'm sure we're going to go on a couple of these other ones. And he was the odd man out. And I think that Washington did a really good job picking him up.
Shen always has this value. I couldn't tell you why, but he's an individual that teams like to have. He's a bigger body. He's a guy who can play physically. And in postseason, that's what you need. But, yeah, the Toronto Maple Leafs acquired Luke Shen. And, for a third-round pick in this year's draft.
I mean, for Toronto, okay, third-round pick, bottom-pairing defenseman. Okay. They're all in too. And, you know, when Boston made that,
you can justify that when your team is Toronto Maple Leafs.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know how, here's the thing. This is, and look at Boston, right? The Orlov Hathaway deal. That was a big deal for them. This is like the last kick of the can for Boston is this year.
For certain it is. And the Edmonton Oilers, right? Matthias Ekholm, that was a guy who was, you know, one of the top defensemen that were going to be moved. Chikrin was moved today. And I'm sorry for all those who just want to listen to all Islander talk. I'm not looking at the comments, but we're going to get to how this ties in with the Islanders. Trust me, bear with us. Please bear with us. But Matthias Ekholm, they're acquired by the Oilers. And, you know, the Predators. Remember Tyson Barrie? Oh, he's so fantastic. Tyson Barrie, so valuable.
He's a scrawny little defenseman. He's like a forward light playing defense.
Reed Schaefer, I think he was last year's first round pick for the Edmonton Oilers. A first round pick in this year's draft and a fourth round pick in 2024.
And Ekholm is a minutes eater. He's going to play on probably their top pair. He'll play with Nurse. And he's going to be a guy who's going to be rock on their penalty kill as well. I like that deal for Edmonton. These are the type of deals they should have been making for a long time.
And Nyquist was acquired for, you know, a fifth round pick, I'm sorry, from Columbus. I was about to say, another was ancillary moves that didn't really amount to too much. The Colorado Avalanche acquire Lars Eller from the Washington Capitals for a 2025 second round pick.
That's an overpay for me.
I think so too.
Looking how everybody else was going for third round picks and Colorado had to give up a second, but just shows you how desperate they were for a center.
Right? Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, they desperately needed a center.
Think about how short and finite that window is for Colorado. How many pieces that are no longer on that team from last year's cup run?
Well, last year, they were all in for last year, and they won the cup.
Yep, so it paid off.
Yep. And the Carolina Hurricanes. Now, here's a move that I think is a little underrated. Gotcha spare. Third-round pick. You're saying
gotcha. 2026 third-round pick. Look at all these draft picks many years down the road getting moved. It's almost like crazy that they have value or something. I'm sorry. Continue, though, Grumpy.
Okay, gotcha spare was unrestricted at the end of the year. They were just looking to move, guys. That's what Arizona does.
Yep, I'm just saying. 2026 third-round pick. Then Philip Hornick. That was one where
This one's a little bit of a head-scratcher for me, right?
I thought that was a good move by Detroit.
Okay, but you have Hornick, who's 24 years old.
Yep.
I think he's tied for second in the team in scoring, got 38 points.
Yep.
They got a first and a second for him. But you know what they're saying? Okay, this is probably not our year, even though mathematically we have more points per game than the Islanders do. They're looking at it, well, you know what? This is not going to be our year in all probability. We might make the playoffs just to be cannon fodder for Boston or Carolina. So, you know what? Let's roll the dice. And they've had some guys who've stepped up defensively for them as well, which made Hornick, expendable for them. And they got a good haul back for him, in my opinion.
They've had a lot of draft picks year after year. They've got guys like Albert Johansson down there. They've got a lot of young defensive prospects that are ready, waiting in the wings. And I'm not saying they're going to step in and replace Hornick without an issue. I'm just saying that that's a guy that they saw who, hey, we can get a return back in one of the deepest drafts that we've seen in what is it, two decades? It's a generational draft class, and we can add a few draft picks without significantly hurting the future of our team.
And like I said, they get a pick that's going to be top 16. So they're probably going to have two picks in the teens or thereabouts. And then a second round, Vancouver's second round pick, which is going to be what, 33, 34?
Yeah. Then Chychrun was traded today. The Ottawa Senators acquired Jacob Chychrun. They gave up a first round pick in this year's draft, a second round pick in next year's draft, and a second round pick in 2026.
Isn't that a good deal for Ottawa, though?
I think so. Remember how much they were claiming Chychrun's going to cost two firsts, a prospect, a player who's making an immediate impact, a young player, all of these items it was going to cost for somebody to acquire Jacob Chychrun. But it requires a first round pick in this year's draft, a second rounder next year, and a second round in 2026.
What did Arizona see, though, right? All the defensemen are off the board.
Yep.
It's like, okay, everyone's already made their, they had to get something for Chychrun. And, you know, that's a first-round pick that's lottery-protected or top-four protected. Ottawa said, you know, they're doing that to maybe make a run at the playoffs this year.
Ottawa, right? We talk about the playoff picture this year. Ottawa has the same amount of points as the Detroit Red Wings, same amount of games played as the Detroit Red Wings. When you look at it, right, both the Red Wings and Ottawa both have, what, four games in hand on the New York Islanders and are 5 points behind, I'm sorry, 6 points behind the New York Islanders.
The playoff picture is like muddled without a doubt. Who's going to get hot down the stretch?
Yes.
That's who's going to make the playoffs. So that, whatever, there's like a 5 or 6 team grouping
Yep.
that you have to look at for those two spots.
Who gets hot? Who starts to play well? Whose power play starts to ignite? Who has, you know, a few lucky bounces go their way? That's seriously what this year's postseason pitcher for the last man in is gonna transpire and come down to. I mean, like the Florida Panthers, right? They've snuck their way back into the conversation, right? They've got two games in hand. They're only 4 points behind the Islanders. The Buffalo Sabres, they lost. I mean, like, yikes, bad.
Catastrophic. Okay. Detroit and Buffalo. Catastrophic meltdowns. And that's what I'm saying. They're young teams. Young teams do that.
Yep.
Buffalo loses to Columbus. But here's the thing. Again, what have I been saying about Buffalo all year? They need a veteran defenseman and a better goalie, like a Varlamov type. They absolutely need that. And they haven't done it. Look at how many goals they give up every game. They can score, but it's like you have to play some defense in this league. They haven't done anything yet. Maybe they will. I don't know. But Detroit losing two games in a row to Ottawa. But then Ottawa's right now is the same record, has been really hot of late.
Yep.
And they're tied with Detroit too. So you got watch out for one of those two teams.
I was about to say, it's like you just have to take care of business. If the Islanders want to make postseason, got to take care of business. Have to win games, Grump.
Yes.
I thought it was odd. Nemesikov, who was signed as a free agent this offseason, was traded this year's trade deadline by the Tampa Bay Lightning. So very, very quick.
Free up some money. That's all that deal is.
So there was a lot of moves that were made. And the Islanders added Pierre Engvall, Rumpy, for a third round pick in next year's draft.
Okay.
Now, here's the thing. He's a bottom six guy. I think he's, you know, he's got speed. He's a bigger guy. But here's the problem that I continue to run into. How does this trade, what's the purpose of this trade? I really don't understand it. And, oh, we've got injuries. That's why we made the trade. Okay. Every team has injuries. And, you know, my question is this. Do we think we're competing for a Stanley Cup this year? I think my confidence level for us winning a Stanley Cup and shining the hardware and the silverware is very low. I do not see us winning a Stanley Cup. I'm sorry. I mean, like, if you think, hey, I got odds that the Islanders are winning the Stanley Cup, we don't see eye to eye. We, you know, we're just on two different wavelengths, and it's a pretty big disparity too. So the
Islanders are not winning the Stanley Cup.
I'm saying there are fans out there who believe that. There are also fans. I made a post about it, and I stirred some shit, as I mentioned at the beginning of the show. People over there saying, oh, it's just a 2024 third round pick. I mean, guys that are third round picks don't even pan out. I love when I hear stupid shit like that. And I'm like, I just can't help thinking, I'm like, yeah, you ever heard of this guy, Braden Point? Yeah, he was just one of those third round picks that don't pan out. And you ever see like guys like Kucherov who slip a little bit into the second round? You can use your third round pick if you're so hell bent to trade up and get a guy who is supposed to be a first-round talent or a guy who's slipping in the draft. You can use your third-round pick as a sweetener to move up and get the guy that you feel is a gem that's slipping. Just throwing away draft picks because, oh, they don't really pan out that often is just stupid. It's a mismanagement of assets.
It's like saying, like I mentioned earlier, Arizona having 27 picks in the first five rounds in the next 3 years. They're not going to pick 27 players.
Correct.
But you know what they do? They move along. They move around the draft board. They move up. They move a third and a second and a late first, and they get into the top 10. I mean, there's so many things you can do. It's just when people say that, they really don't know much about the game, or I won't say the game, but how teams are built for the long term. It's not fantasy hockey, everyone. It really isn't. I mean, if you want to be a good team consistently year after year, you have to have draft picks. You look at Washington, look at the picks they've picked up in the last 3 or 4 days. They moved five veterans now. And they picked up, you know, a couple of seconds, a couple of thirds, and they got a young defenseman to replace Orlov. That's a win. Brian McClellan's done a really nice job as GM there. Those are the type of things that I wish our GM had been a little bit proactive and just thought a little bit realistically about the chances of the team. There's no way that Lou Lamoriello thinks his team is good enough to win a cup. I cannot believe at the end of the day that he really believes that. Because we've been up and down all year, up and down, up and down, up and down. We've not got really hot for long stretches or played really, really bad for long stretches. We'll win. We'll look good for three games. We'll look crappy for three games. That's not a team that's winning the Stanley Cup.
Yeah. And, you know, again, the heart back on this point, like Jason Robertson, right? Guy who's killing it, right? For the Dallas Stars. Jason Robertson, fantastic player. He's the guy who slipped in the draft. Supposed to be one of those guys who's a first-round talent, slipped to be an early second-round pick. He was 39th overall. He's a guy who, right, 60 games played, 35 goals, 38 assists. You can use your third-round pick if it's an anomaly when they pan out. That's fine. Use it to trade up and get an earlier second-round pick on a guy that's slipping that you thought was a first-round talent. You don't have to think in some box as if I have a third-round pick, I must select that third-round pick and cannot trade that to move up the draft board to get a more talented player.
It's like, you know, if somebody slides like an Aturatu.
Correct.
That's a guy you could pick up, you know, with a second. Oh, well, it's just a second round pick. Yeah, well, but then you can get somebody like that and then foolishly trade them later. But, you know, it just kind of is what it is at this point. I mean, I just
remember Joe Valeno. He was a guy who was supposed to be penciled in bar top none, five. Early, top no, not top five, but he was supposed to be an early to mid first round pick, and he slipped all the way to 30th. He's still young, 23 years old, but he's a guy where it's like, hey, I've played 59 games for the Red Wings. I've got 16 points. He's looked pretty competent. I've watched some of their games, but it's like, that's a guy where he slipped in the draft to a late first round pick, a guy who's supposed to be a mid first round pick. You're able to identify that, and you could trade up and give up your third round pick if you're so hell bent on it. Right. But just carelessly throwing away draft capital just doesn't make sense.
We've done that before to pick up like Brock Nelson.
We traded up to go ahead and get Brock Nelson. Yeah, go ahead.
Anthony Beauvillier. These are guys that we all made deals to move up. Or Calvin DeHaan back in the day. We moved a bunch of picks to move up. Wound up moving five picks to get Calvin DeHaan. That was not a really, you know, think about it. That wasn't the best asset management. But these are the type of things that you can do.
Yeah.
You use those picks in later rounds and you just move up, you know, 15 spots, 20 spots to get the player that you really like. So, I mean, just don't, I don't know how anyone would think, hey, let's go into the draft with no draft picks. That's going to work to build the team. No, sorry. And here's the thing, Engvall. Okay. Well, who are you moving off your team next year? Does that mean that Zach Parise absolutely doesn't come back? I thought Zach Parise played well last night, by the way.
Hold on, take a breath. Yeah, I thought he played well too, but think about this. He played well, of course, going back to Minnesota. That's probably the best game I've seen from him in weeks.
Yes. But does that mean that, okay, well, we definitely are not bringing Zach Parise back. Definitely not bringing him back. Stop doing that. I hate when you do it. Just stop.
What game are you
watching? Stop it. Just stop it. While I'm talking, just mind your manners. So here's the thing. For me, if they sign Engvall back, what does that mean? You can only have so many bottom six guys. Our team is loaded with. Does that mean that you cut loose Cal Clutterbuck? Cut loose Matt Martin at the end of the year? Is Hunter Fashing going to be gone?
Hudson Fashing?
Whatever. Yeah,
you keep calling him Hunter, and I got blamed for that when that was your fault, Grumpy.
Well, that's why I'm calling him that, because that's what you've called. Last night, I think when I talked to you, I called him Hudson.
No bullshit. Anyway, the thought process is this team has to be so dependent and has to, oh my gosh, we cannot afford a guy like this. He might not make it to free agency. Or, hey, if Engvall makes it to free agency, he might not pick the Islanders. And, oh no, we're going to need him to be on this team. What, guys, has the bigotry of low expectations dropped so unbelievably low that we believe that we can't even sign a bottom six forward? We can't entice a bottom six forward to join the New York Islanders if we offered him during free agency. Literally, this move was, hey, we think we're making a push for a guy that was going to be a free agent come July 1st. We think we can make a push for this year's Stanley Cup. So we're giving up a third round pick to potentially win this year's Stanley Cup.
Yeah, I want to see I want to see if in his first interview he's tapping out Morris code. Help me.
I've signed a 6 or 7 year extension for $2.5 million per. Oh,
could you imagine that? Mm-mm-mm. He was expendable by Toronto.
Correct.
He was odd man out.
He does a good job. He's a good.
Yeah, he's a serviceable bottom six guy.
You need blood and guts guys like that on the ice. You certainly do. And those guys are fan favorites. But are those guys you have to give up third round picks because you feel, number one, enamored with them when your team's not going to make a cup run, and because I cannot afford the possibility that we can't sign him for free in free agency? We gave up a third round pick where we could have had him for free. I don't get that. I don't understand it.
To me, for where this team is, it was kind of just an unnecessary move. If you're a team like Tampa or Boston or Toronto, I could absolutely see you make a move like that.
Mikael Grunlund has been traded to the Pittsburgh Penguins for a second-round pick in 2023. That's a great move by the Penguins. That is a fantastic move by the Penguins. Wow. Mikael Grunlund. I've always liked him for Nashville, and that's a team, Nashville, who is transitioning. They're going to have first-time general manager there, Barry Trotz, this upcoming year. It's going to be very reminiscent of his old coaching days where we're blowing the team up from scratch.
I mean, again, Pittsburgh, right? Pittsburgh's got to be all in. They can't be anything but.
Exactly.
With that roster. You can't be anything but.
The other thing, too, with Washington hasn't just blown the entire thing apart. They said, gotcha, we're going to refortify and look towards next year. Maybe we're still going to give ourselves a chance to compete this year. We're not rolling over and dying. That's not the mentality they're taking. But in the same token, I mean, it wasn't like they said, oh, okay, we're getting rid of Hanson, we're getting rid of Orlov, and we're just going to leave those spots vacant for young players to come and fill. No, they said, let's get Sandin. Let's get a guy who's got cost certainty, who can play for us this year and in the future, that helps us transition to a younger core.
You pick up a 22-year-old defenseman. You can add and subtract at the same time. It's what I wish the Islanders would have done. Like I said, the Horvat trade in a bubble I would have liked it if we were subtracting as well, because I think Bo Horvat's a really good player. Everyone knows who listens to this show. He's a guy I'd love on this team. Absolutely. I thought we overpaid a little bit just because he was a free agent. I think we paid too much for him for 8 years. You know, whatever. The salary cap's going to be going up, so it won't be that big of an issue. But you can still subtract and fortify your future, and I just don't think we're going to do that. And I just, to me, that's the most frustrating thing.
Yeah, there's no way in hell we're selling anything at this year's trade deadline. So here we go, ladies and gentlemen. What could happen this offseason? You could lose a guy like Varlamov for nothing. You could lose a guy like Mayfield for nothing. You can lose a guy like Parise for nothing, when every single one of those players have value and could have returned you back something this year.
Let me ask you a question. Is Zach Parise just as valuable as Pierre Engvall?
He must be indispensable, Grumpy.
But I'm just saying, if he was on the market, wouldn't that be a guy that you... I mean, here's the thing. I'd have no problem with Engvall replacing Parise. None at all.
I think that's... When I saw that trade, I said, okay, I guess Parise is retiring at the end of this year. Because, right, that's a guy who prototypically, when the roster's healthy, they're not going to say, hey, we're going to sit the guy if we sign it. If big if, right? If we sign Engvall here, you know, they're not going to sit him.
Yeah, I mean... I would expect them to re-sign him. I mean, when Lamoriello makes a trade, he pretty much, that's the only way he's able to get anybody, is trade for him and give him an overpriced, too long-term deal. That's what he does. So
give him a full no-trade clause for the first 4 years, and the next four, a modified no-trade clause. We'll give it to a bottom six forward, just like we did Casey, just like we did Cal. We do it all the time.
I mean, but then you have to move Parise.
Parise might retire.
Try to get something, but what have you done? You've done, in essence, if you move Parise for a third round pick, let's say, what you've done is the same thing Washington did by replacing an older Orlov with a younger Sandin. See, yeah. I mean, I have no problem with that.
And does that help make the immediate team better? Maybe, maybe not. But guess what? It helps a team who has one of the older forward groups in the NHL start to transition. That's exactly what it does.
And that's what we should be doing. This way, it's not going to be, boy, it's like Niagara Falls.
I was going to say, it's not like you get hit, like where you wake up after a night of drinking when you just got a huge hangover, just like, boom, it's in your face and it's there and it's not going away. Or just like you snap the leg in half where it's like the pain, the searing pain is going to be there. It's going to last for a while. Mind if we were in a different position trading for Engvall? If we had top-end talent, if we were a team that was competing for a cup? No, I wouldn't have minded a trade like that at all, because I think it's a good value pick. I thought it was a good value pickup when you look at it in an isolated situation. But when you look at it pertaining to the Islanders, I don't think it's the right philosophy.
Right. The East, whoever wins the Eastern Conference is winning the Stanley Cup this year, in my opinion.
Unless they beat the hell out of each other and the Western Conference winner comes out where they don't play as many games and they're fresher.
Yeah, I just don't think the teams in the West are that good.
I don't know.
I don't expect any team to walk through the West like Colorado did last year, playing a beat-up Tampa team. I just don't see that. I think you're going to see a lot of seven-game series in the West. I think it's going to be fun to watch, and I don't think I think Dallas is right now the top team in the West. I don't think that makes them a favorite to come out of the West, to be honest with you. But, I mean, Eastern Conference, the top six teams in the East are all capable of winning a Stanley Cup.
Yeah.
But only the top six teams.
It's a gauntlet. We don't have the right, we're not fortified enough in order to win a cup. And that's the first question. When you look at this and how it applies to the Islanders, so ask yourself first, do you think the Islanders are going to win a Stanley Cup this year?
No.
I don't. And I think that most level-headed Islander fans would agree. Once you ask that, go ahead, Grumpy.
Go ahead. Finish your point. Please finish your point.
You're not going to go ahead and win a Stanley Cup this year. Why not have saved the draft pick, and gone ahead and attempted to sign him as a free agent if you were so infatuated with his play and thought he was going to be such a long-term solution. You could have done that too. But go ahead, Grump.
Or you could have just brought him in, moved Parise to recoup the third-round draft pick.
That too.
And then you've gotten younger and potential long-term, you're better at that spot.
But it does not fit with their – this is my point. It's not what their philosophy is. That's why I said it's the wrong philosophy, because guess what? We have injuries right now, and they need Engvall not only for the right now, but also for the future. So they said, great, two birds, one stone. We can't trade away Parise because we need him for the right now. A smart general manager would have said, yeah, maybe the team's not constructed well enough to win a Stanley Cup this year or possibly next year, so we can recruit it and pretty much just trade it, and we can have the security that we get Engvall. We can secure him, that we can sign him early, because we've got to bring everybody on Long Island for a trial run to make sure that they understand how fantastic of a place it is, because we can never sign a free agent to freaking play for the Islanders.
Yeah. Like, for me, it's frustrating. And I said, like, six teams who have a chance to win a cup, the Rangers are number six, and I don't think they're going to win. I just don't think they're
flawed defensively.
I don't think they're good enough. Neither but every way. Other team, if you know the if you know the if the tumblers if the tumblers kind of fall right, an injury here or there, I think any one of Carolina, the Devils, Boston, Toronto, or Tampa Bay would be Stanley Cup champions this year.
It could be tough for the Devils just because it's their first time going back to the playoffs in how many years. There's a lot of first-timers that they're going to be on that roster. That's a little different.
Yeah. Shesterkin has not been as good this year. I think Jersey's going to beat the Rangers.
Wow.
I just think they can skate with the Rangers. I think they're better defensively. I like what the Devils have done. I really do.
I'm telling you, there's still moves to be made, and I still think there are moves that are going to be made before this year's trade deadline. But it's just the team continuing to add on a team that's past their peak in an iteration that is not designed to win now. But our general manager thinks they are.
When I look at the and just to piggyback off of you know the possible trades, no goaltenders have really. I mean, Corpusalo for Quick, okay, big deal. Corpusalo is just going to split time with the other guy in Los Angeles. But for just looking at how bad the goaltending is around the league, what's the value of Varlamov right now?
I think a first rate last year, Marc-Andre Fleury, what was he moved for a second round pick? And he was head over heels better than Varlamov. He was coming off of 2 years ago or the year before he was traded. He won the Vezina, I think. But put it in perspective. Goaltending is hideous this year in the NHL. If we do not trade away Varlamov, we're saying, because right at the NHL trade deadline, we will have remaining 20 games remaining on the schedule.
Not for us. We played 63. How many games we played this year? We're not 20 games left.
I'm sorry. We'll have 18 games remaining.
18. Yeah.
We'll have 18 games remaining come this Friday because our game is not until Saturday, I believe. We play the Red Wings on Saturday, Grump.
Saturday afternoon.
Hey, gotcha. Saturday, 12:30, a matinee game. But we're in a spot to where we could realistically over an 18-game stretch, how many of those do you expect Varlamov to play? Four? Maybe five games?
That's it. Four, maybe four.
Four, maybe. And here's the thing. If you make the postseason, let's say somehow the Islanders make the postseason, they're not running a 1A, 1B goalie tandem with Sorokin at the helm. Sorokin is playing every single game if you make the postseason. Oh, or no, we're going to have to sign him back. Well, shit, if he loves the Islanders so much, you could sign him back as a free agent come July 1st if he's so infatuated and he didn't want to leave and he really loved the New York Islanders. You could just sign him back for free on July 1st. Well, what I think he'll probably get paid like a starting goalie because he is still a starting goalie in the NHL, unless he says, I want to be with my buddy Sorokin and I don't care what I get paid and I don't care if I play. That's not how most professional athletes think, but maybe he does. That's the only scenario that I see him coming back.
That's the way the cul-de-sac crew thinks.
Ah, good point. Good
point. Doesn't matter if we win, really not that important. It's about, you know, personal comfort and hanging out with my buddies. It's great if you can get the job like that. Don't have to perform. Don't have to win. Doesn't really matter. We're all pals. I mean, that's great. But yeah. I don't know.
You know what I could see the Islanders doing? I could see the Islanders, if they want to bring Varlamov back, signing him to a four-year extension or a five-year extension, a 34-year-old goalie. I could seriously see him doing that, Lou Lamoriello.
He's 35. I can't see him. I can't see anything more than a two-year deal. A two-year deal 1.5 per, and then whatever else goes to Sorokin. You need to sign Sorokin this offseason to an extension. You can't wait until he becomes a free agent. It's just dumb. That should be number one on the hit parade for the Islanders, signing Sorokin back.
Yeah.
Everybody else, all the little ancillary pieces that he likes to sign back, you know, shut your mouth, don't say anything, we're not going to announce it until a week before training camp. No, you guys are waiting. Sorokin's more important because we need to make sure we have the money for the best player on the team.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't disagree. That's just the way, and whatever's left, that's what you guys get to divvy up if you want to stay. I mean, he probably won't operate like that, but that's what he should do.
I agree. So, you know, Varlamov, I guess 4 or 5 games possibly of Varlamov is worth more. I mean, 4 or 5 games of Varlamov, is that worth a second-round pick plus, possibly a first-round pick? I would take a first-round pick as opposed to 4 or 5 games of Varlamov. I don't know about the fans out there. I don't know about the listeners out there. What do you find more valuable, 4 games of Varlamov or possibly a first-round pick or a second-round pick?
Well, that's what it is.
That's the decision you're making.
A lot of fans say, well, what if Sorokin gets hurt? Well, Sorokin gets hurt, it doesn't matter anyway.
What if Sorokin gets hurt? We're fucked. If we make the postseason, we'll be swept if Sorokin gets hurt. He's a top 5 netminder in the NHL, and he's one of the few reasons we stay in games. Yeah. If we don't have Sorokin, you know, our chance goes from 0.001% to freaking so small you can't count the number. That's how many freaking zeros are going to be in front of that one.
0.001 is pretty small anyway.
It's going to be even smaller than that, Grump.
Okay.
Anyway, I want to go ahead, Grump. I'm going to start getting some ads because I want to start reading some comments here, Grumpy, okay. For today's podcast. So hopefully we can get through some more comments than we usually do. Today's podcast is brought to you by 2 different sponsors, Grumpy. You know those two sponsors, Grumpy?
Why don't you tell us?
Trying to get pulled up, damn it. I was hoping you could buy me a second.
Probably going to be don't worry.
DraftKings, as well as Raycon. NBA fans, it's time to bring the hoops action to the palm of your hand with DraftKings Sportsbook, an official sports betting partner of the NBA. This week, new customers can bet $5 and win $200 in free bets instantly. Plus, for a limited time, all new and the keyword and existing customers can get a no-sweat same-game parlay every day. Go to the DraftKings Sportsbook app today, opt in, and place a same-game parlay on any NBA game. And if it doesn't hit, you'll get a free bet back. Again, so you could say, I'm expecting, Grumpy, the Charlotte Hornets to lose. I'm expecting the Lakers to lose now without LeBron James. You can go ahead and bet any type of parlay you want. But download the app now and sign in with promo code THPN. New customers can bet $5 on the NBA and get $200 in free bets instantly only at DraftKings Sportsbook, an official sports betting partner of the NBA. Again, with promo code THPN. Minimum age and eligibility restrictions apply. It's void in Ohio. And see the notes in the description for additional details. And additionally, we've got an ad today to read from Raycon. It's this time of the year, and everybody's talking about making big changes, which is all well and good, but most of the time pretty unrealistic. You know, I've actually found that sometimes the smallest changes to your routine can make the biggest impact. And in the same way, you don't have to break the bank with them to make a big deal purchase. You know,
like trading a guy like Zach Parise?
Yeah, exactly. You could trade away a guy like Parise and just replace him with Engvall, and boom, one hand washes the other. Even the smallest things can be part of a big change. I'm sorry. And it could be something that you use every day, kind of like my Raycon headphones. Raycon's a premium audio brand and at a perfect price point. So, you know, you can build great habits without breaking the bank. You got a good pair of headphones for reading. You've got a good pair of headphones when you're out there at the gym. You're getting lost in the music, getting workout, getting the pump in, Grumpy. You can get a nice pair of headphones going. And whether you're looking for a pair of everyday earbuds, low latency gaming headphones, or a speaker with a battery that will last you all night, your next party, Raycon has got you covered. And yep, Raycon start at half the price of other premium audio brands. So you don't even have to choose between products. You know, you can get one of each, a pair and a spare, and still pay less than you would with some of the other guys. And even if, you know, you'll love your Raycons as much as I do, Raycon wants you, you know, to feel great about your purchase. They offer a buy now and pay later option. Ooh. And every purchase has easy and free return guarantee. What I like about the Raycon headphones, obviously the gel tips, they fit the contours of your ears. You've got the tap functionality. So when someone comes to bother you, Jim, boop, boop, I can go ahead and hit stop and talk with them really quickly. Okay. And again, and it's water and sweat resistant. That is a huge one. You got to make sure that they don't break. They're not, you know, a piece of garbage over there. Anyway, if you're ready to buy something small with a big impact, go to buyraycon.com/THPN today to get 15% off your Raycon order. That's buyraycon.com/THPN to buy to score 15% off. Buyraycon.com/THPN for 15% off.
Nice.
Remember, Grumpy, as Grumpy says, buy one, get the other one half off, as Grumpy said the last show.
That's what I thought it said.
Obviously a joke. Obviously a joke. But let's start jumping into some comments. Dale S. said, the cul-de-sac crew is an all-time classic quote.
Thank you, Dale.
People get pissed off when we call them the cul-de-sac crew, too.
Who gets pissed off at that?
People online do, Grumpy.
That's what it is, though.
We were told so many mean things when I said, I made a little funny tweet, Grumpy, and we told so many mean things like, oh, coming from the two guys that do a podcast in their mom's basement. And I cried because I'm in mom's basement. I'm in the warden's basement, Grump. And I couldn't control my emotions.
I don't know why you get involved in that stuff.
Here's the thing. When you look online, and you see everybody just mindlessly celebrating like sheep or like a seal. This is great. We're winning the Stanley Cup. You're just like, Jesus Christ, please.
I'm telling you the reason is because the Islanders have been such losers for so long that this is making the playoffs is a substantial victory in their lives. It is. And I can understand that.
I don't.
If you were a Boston Red Sox fan who hadn't won a World Series in, 70, 80 years, making it to the World Series. Oh, my God, we qualified for the playoffs.
They didn't do that when they qualified for the playoffs. That was the expectation because just like New York, Boston also has high expectation for their sports teams. Okay. And the freaking Celtics barely scratched the playoffs. They're like, what the fuck? The Celtics are sucking ass. The same thing with the Boston Red Sox. The same thing all the way around. The same thing with the New England Patriots. Because when you are in a winning town, you expect winning from all your sports teams. But for whatever reason, the Islanders just are some anomaly where we say, well, we don't have to expect them to be fantastic and spectacular, but we want that out of the Yankees. We want that out of the Mets. Are we happy when the Mets don't make the postseason? No, we're ready to burn freaking Citi Field to the ground. The same thing with the Yankees. It's the same thing across the board in New York sports. Right. But hey, with the Giants, with the Jets, right? The Jets are kind of miserable. But think about this. If the Jets got to a point where they made a few playoffs, would you think Jets fans like, oh, man, we might make the postseason?
Exactly what Jets fans would do.
The first time they make the postseason, it would make sense. But if you go from a spot where, hey, we made it to back-to-back AFC championship games, we don't make the postseason next year, you think they're saying, we might have a chance to make the postseason as a super wild card spot. No, they're going to say, damn, our expectation is that our team wins games.
Well, that's what happened with the Jets in the late 90s, early with Vinny Testaverde and Bill Parcells' coach. They made the two straight AFC championship games and lost. But the Jets are historically a loser team. So are the Islanders. I hate to tell everyone that, except for our first, 15 years?
We've been around for 50 years and we've won 4 cups. I wouldn't call that a loser franchise.
No, but we've been a loser franchise for the last, 35 years?
2-3 decades, sure.
But here's the thing. Most people who are watching, who listen to this show, listen to a lot of shows, who are, listen to podcasts, they're probably younger people for the most part. Our demographic is a little bit older, but you go to some of these other things, right? A lot of younger people, they don't know success. They think making the playoffs is a success. It's not. It's not. And here's the thing. Charlotte Hornets, okay? They made it when they first started. They made it to the Eastern Conference semifinals one year, and it was a big deal. But then they've been losers all the time. Now, if they make the playoffs, like, woo, we made the playoffs. Load up for the playoff run. No. It's the same thing. When you're used to losing a little bit of success, you get a little bit of success, like, oh, we got to make sure, we got to keep this run going. No, you want to build something that's lasting and sustainable. The Islanders right now just are not. I mean, I hate to disappoint people, but it's just the truth. Anyone who tells you different is just deluding themselves. And at the end of the day, when the, you know, the chips are down, the dust is settled, guess what? This show is going to be proven correct once again, like it is every year. I'll tell people when we're ready to win. I'll tell you when we're ready to win. I'll tell you when we need to start loading up. Then I'll tell you when that's going to happen. Now's not the time, though, and I'm not going to lie to you. I'm just going to tell you the truth.
Hold on, Grumpy. You don't want us to add more pick? You don't want us to add more pieces at this year's trade deadline?
Nope.
I think we should add another defenseman.
Well, here's the thing. They had a chance to add Shane Gotcha spare. Third-round pick? Why not? He can move the puck.
We already have enough defensemen that don't play defense.
Well, it's true.
Oh, man, oh, man. So, yeah. I would understand it if all the teams in New York sucked so bad.
Most of the teams in New York do suck most of the time.
That's not true. That's just not true. Let's look at the last two decades. How many World Series did the Yankees win in the last 20 years?
One.
How many Super Bowls did the Giants win?
Two. Yeah. You're talking about almost a quarter century. Okay? Rangers, zero cups. That's Islanders, true. Zero cups. That's Mets, true. Zero championships.
That's damn bastard Yankee. The Yankees only won once. They won in, oh, I guess 2001, 20 years ago. Yeah.
2009 will be the last. Yeah. You're 20. That's since 2003 to 2009.
Sure.
Giants have two.
Yeah.
2007,
the Giants, the G-Men, Grumpy.
2007, 2011. But in between, they're abysmal.
You know, the funny thing I was talking about yesterday, I was thinking about, you know, 3-4 years from now, I really hope the Giants and the Mets are juggernauts, because I'll need something else to do besides watch Islanders hockey, because we're going to be so abysmal by that point. Have to hope the other teams I like and adore, like the Giants, like the Mets, are going to be fantastic teams, because they're going to have to take my sorrows away.
Think about this. 80 opportunities. Well, actually, no. 160 opportunities to win a championship for New York sports teams since 2003. Eight teams times 20 years. That's 160 chances to win a Super Bowl, NBA, NHL, MLB championship. They have three. What winning percentage is that?
Okay, well, they're also competing against a million other teams.
Three.
They're competing against a million other teams.
They have twice as many chances to win a championship than anywhere else, because there's two teams in every single sport. Three out of 160 chances in the last 20 years.
You count Buffalo in that list?
Is that a winning city? I'm not even including Buffalo. The Kings are the losers. I'm not even talking about that. They haven't won anything ever. Buffalo. No. Buffalo Sabres. I'm talking about the New York area. I'm not throwing the Devils in there. They're a Jersey team. They have Jersey in front of their name.
Joseph C. said, don't think I've ever seen an NHL trade deadline this busy. And it's not even over yet. All these buying general managers saying, F those picks.
Here's what I really find interesting. I think everyone's seeing Boston and saying, if we want to have any shot to beat them this year, we have to load up.
Yep.
And is Boston capable of getting beat? Yep. But I think that trade they made really fortified them.
Yeah. Orloff is an important piece. Goon Goon says, Grumpy! Dale S. says, TJ, late as usual. Guys, Freedom Fund Official says, guys, TJ just messaged me that he was getting his Brazilian bikini wax, but wanted everybody to know there is a show tonight. That's correct. I'm sorry. That's why I was running a little late. I was getting my whatever, the Brazilian bikini wax.
No comment.
I do have something to show you, Grumpy.
Please don't tell me it's your Brazilian bikini wax.
No. Steve S., a listener of the show, said, I ran into Anders Lee today at Party City on Long Island. He's a really nice guy. The funny thing was he was getting balloons made up to say Grumpy's number one fan.
Yeah.
Now, here's the thing. I bet Anders, here's the thing. Everybody, I don't think I've ever made a hockey. The vast majority of hockey players are just the best guys. Here's the thing. Most of them are not from the United States. That's probably part of the reason. Now, Anders Lee is, and I'm certain he's a tremendous guy. I'd love to meet him. I bet you he would not spit on me. I mean, I would tell him who I was, and he might scowl at me a little bit because I'm sure he's been told.
He'll have that permanent frowny face on. As soon as you walk up, he's like, who?
But here's the thing. I have the ability to charm the stripes off of a tiger.
Oh, fucking stop.
And I could absolutely do that with my pal Average.
Oh, man. But thank you, Steve, for sending it in. It's crazy. He spotted him at Party City. He was spelling out Grumpy's number one fan in balloons. I mean, like, that was like $100 worth of balloons he was putting in there.
Can Grumpy. I ask you a question?
Uh-huh.
If, now I'm not going to say a name of former players, but let's say somebody like Patrick Mahomes. Do you think he could just wander into Party City without getting, like, engulfed by people?
Oh, my God, it's just Patrick Mahomes. Can I take a picture with you? Oh,
I remember Stephen Smith Sr. He used to be a wide receiver for the Carolina Panthers.
I thought he was Steve Smith Jr.
No, he was senior. His kids were junior. He changed his name from Steve Smith to Stephen Smith Sr., whatever. He used to, one year he had a broken leg and he would go into a store and we saw him once. He was in Kmart, of all places.
Kmart.
But he had a security guard around him and he wouldn't let anybody get near him. Now, Anders Lee is not like that.
That's true.
Obviously. But the fact that Stephen Smith Sr. felt that he had to have someone, you know, bodyguard him going shopping. Come on. You're not going to see that from any of the Islanders. Maybe Matty B.
Can you make sure that you're not yanking on that string there, please, Grumpy? Because that does. I don't like hearing that. But yeah, you're right, Grumpy. You're right. Normal people. They're good people. I've got no issue with any of them as people. They are outstanding individuals. Only thing I don't like is the product on the ice. That's it. Other than that, I'll grab a beer with you. I'll shoot the shit with you. I'm sure you're great people, good people. I have no issue. You're not Sean Avery. I'd say a resounding majority of NHL players are fantastic individuals, fantastic
people.
You see the charitable work they do. It is fantastic across the board. And the Islanders are they're no exception in a negative way to that. The great people, great organization. They feel like family. Absolutely, they do.
Yep.
Frank K says here, this team has no shot at beating anyone in the playoffs.
That's right, Frank. Let's get this podcast back on track. Tell him, Frank.
Nick C. I'm okay with the Engvall trade, even though I think we should sell. We didn't give up. He's youngish. Plus, we have a lot of injuries. We still need to field a team. Plus, Otto Koivula should be sent down then. I mean, like, when we're losing games, is it Otto Koivula's fault?
No.
And, you know, it's just like, this is my point.
But, okay, but Otto Koivula doesn't make a difference either.
Correct. My point is this, though. I think third round picks have value.
Yes,
they do. All draft picks have value. You can use them to trade up the draft board to get a guy that you think slips where it's like, hey, in the late part, oh, man, we gave up a third round pick at this year's trade deadline. And, you know, we only have a fifth round pick because of something else that happened. But we see a guy who we had projected being a possible late second, early third round pick that's slipping into the fifth round. Holy crap. We need to trade up to get that guy. There are moments like that. And having draft capital and draft picks available to have the freedom and flexibility to acquire the players you think that can make a difference on your team is important. That's important. Do not let that be undervalued.
And I look at it as, you know, maybe I always say when you're getting later in the draft, you're looking for guys who have a specific
skill set
trait.
Yeah.
That, oh man, this kid's really a great skater. This guy's a tremendous shot. This guy has great vision. And that's where you target guys who have a specific skill set. So maybe you can work with that skill set that's elite by sanding off the rough edges of his game. When you don't have picks, you can't do that. I mean, it's just, again, draft picks are the lifeblood of an organization.
When you hit on, like Anders Lee, he's a guy who has far exceeded any expectation anyone could have had for him. On draft night.
What round was he?
Oh, sixth round pick, if I
remember. Sixth round pick. Just traded for somebody. Well, we didn't need that sixth round pick. You know, for all that shit that I give Anders Lee, for a sixth round pick, that's an A-plus pick. A-plus-plus
is right for what he's done and what he's overcome for where he was drafted and selected. He's been fantastic. He's fulfilled my wildest expectations I could have ever had for a sixth-round pick. He was the last pick. Casey Cizikas in that same draft class was a fourth-round pick, a guy who's played 727 games in his NHL career as, you know, a career bottom-six guy who's been an integral part of the system, right? Oh, we don't need fourth-round picks. They don't pan out to be anything. Eh, we don't need them. Trade them away. We don't need fourth-round picks, guys.
And I'm going to say once again, Anders Lee is a perfect example of what I'm talking about. He's a big body who can get and his skill set that he's really good at, deflecting pucks, using his big body to get in front of the net, screening goaltenders. And guess what? The rest of his game is not great, but he has that one elite skill that they've been able to work around. And that's what I'm saying. When you're picking late, those are the type you're looking for, a trait that can translate to the NHL long term.
Think about the year before. You look at the year before. Jared Spurgeon, sixth round pick, a guy who was an undersized defenseman, a small guy before the league started to change to where it was more, you know, more of a pass happy defenseman, needs to be able to provide offensive outlets, you know, before that occurred. And Matt Martin was a fifth round pick. A guy who was he's an enforcer, he's a bruiser, he's a blood and guts type of guy. But he's found his way into an everyday 880 games for his career with Matt Martin. But that fifth round pick didn't matter. Jared Spurgeon, who still plays in the NHL, we played him yesterday. That sixth round pick didn't matter, guys. We don't need to worry about keeping those picks because they don't pan out. Andrew McDonald, when we draft him as a sixth round pick and trade him to the Flyers for a second or a third, whatever the hell it was, that sixth round pick didn't matter. Like, that type of freaking mentality is the reason why you do not know how to manage the team efficiently. Devon Taves, fourth round pick. That one didn't matter. A late third round pick or a third round pick doesn't really matter. The 2024 draft class isn't as deep. Devon Taves, fourth round pick in that 2014 draft class. I'd say that one panned out. You have to have enough kicks at the can in order to be successful. Do I think we're going to be able to hit on every single third round pick or fourth round pick? Absolutely not. But when you have enough of them to where it almost becomes foolproof, you set yourself up for a higher chance of success. Yep. It's that simple.
Very true. And that's, you know, for me, like I said, I don't have a problem with the Engvall deal. I don't. But you know what? You got so many of those guys. Move Parise. What's the difference? Maybe you get a third round pick back. You've gotten younger. You have your Parise replacement. You got a guy who's 26 as opposed to a guy who's 38.
He'll be 27 like a month. But you got a guy who next year will be 27 years old in the prime of his career.
And that's a guy you could have. I mean, because he's a fine bottom six guy. That's a guy you could have for another 5-6 years. Yep. I mean, Parise is not going to be here 5 or 6 years. That would be smart to do something like that. I just don't know if Lamoriello is capable of it, to be honest with you.
Drill said, honestly, I know TJ in particular hates this trade, but Engvall is a speedy guy who has the chance to become a decent top six forward. He has just never gotten an opportunity, Toronto. He's 6'5" and he's fast.
His hands aren't good enough.
Oh, no. We were told on Twitter that he's got silky smooth hands.
He's a bottom six guy, period. A bottom six guy.
If you're 27 years old and you've been a bottom six guy your entire NHL career, it's not like, oh, the Toronto Maple Leafs were the thing that were holding you back. If you're good enough, the talent will eventually prevail by the time you're 27 years old. You're going to win, or 26, be 27 in a month or so from now. I think he's a guy who's a bottom six forward, and that's fine. I just didn't understand the need to have him for this season to give up a third round pick next year. That didn't make sense. What's up, Frank? How are you? Andrew L says, would you rather have seen the Islanders use a third rounder for Goss to spare like Carolina did, or stick with Engvall? And don't do neither, Grumpy.
I don't hate the Engvall deal. I don't. But you can't have 9 bottom six guys on your roster going to the next. You just can't. I mean, if you're moving Parise for a third round pick, what's the difference? To me, that's a win for the Islanders. It really is. A big win. You get somebody who can be who's going to play on your team in the bottom six role for how many years?
As maybe 4 or 5 years as a guy who could be serviceable.
That's a win. That's a big win.
You gave up a guy who might retire at the end of this year for a guy who could be there for 4 to 5 years, and you didn't have. And it's like it was treated exactly like a win in the offseason because you were able to offset it with another third round pick you received back. It's a net neutral.
There's no reason to sign Parise back if you can re-sign Engvall. No reason at all.
If you can't re-sign Engvall, it makes that trade even stupider.
Well, okay.
If you can't sign back Engvall, you literally traded a third-round pick for a rental when your team had no shot in hell to win a cup.
Okay, if you want to look at it that way, yeah.
No matter what.
I thought that was a good deal for Carolina, getting Gotchaspare. They're in a different place than we are. I just trading away any draft capital is just foolish at this point in time for this year. I mean, if you want to get some younger guys, like if Sandin had become available, okay, sure. I have no problem trading for Sandin and moving a second and a third.
I would have been fine moving. And again, I'm not sure exactly what side defenseman that Sandin plays, but I would have been fine. Dude, I don't like Romanoff. Romanoff is a freaking abomination out there on the ice. Moving a guy like Romanoff for Sandin, I'd have been fine with something like that.
It depends on what you bring in.
Sure.
Like,
sure.
Bo Horvat, 27 years old. He's going to be 28. Okay. In the long run, probably the last few years are going to be painful to watch.
Yeah.
But here's the thing. He's really good, and he's under 30. And I happen to like him too, which helps.
It helps your
name. It does. But I can see that going forward. Engvall. If you're keeping Parise and Engvall, why?
They need more depth.
I just wish we'd move some of the guys who are UFAs. There's no reason to keep a UFA on this team, not one.
John Smith said, why put the countdown on if you're late already? I don't know. Just gives everybody a chance to get ready for the show and gives them all the notification time so they don't miss anything. Put up at Curtis says, boys, what D-list Islanders celebrity guest are we having on this evening? Oh man, Pony boy. It just means that you're late. You're more late, says John Smith. Oh no. Oh man. Trey Dobson before it's too late, says D-Cut. The amount of fans who think that Noah Dobson, I'm really worried about Noah Dobson. He's really struggling. But in the same breath, they'll say, Romanoff is so young. Romanoff can still improve. They're the same fucking age. Romanoff is a day older than Noah Dobson, actually.
Dobson is so much better than Romanoff. I can't even have a discussion with someone who has that type of thought process.
A lot of people have that thought process because I don't think critical thinking is just one of those things that I don't know.
The thing. I bet you his whole career that Romanoff won't score as many points as Dobson has scored so far in his first 3 or 4 years.
It's not all about points, right?
No, but that's what Dobson does. Yeah, he's a puck-moving defenseman. Romanoff is not that. He's supposed to be a rock-solid defender. He's not that either. That's a problem. Can he get better? I don't know. I think he'd be smarter positionally than he is now. He hits. You knew he's going to be fan favorite. Why? Because he hits.
Yeah.
And he blocks shots. That's what he does. That's all he does. Because he's never in position. Never freaking ever is he in position.
And the other thing too about Dobson, consistently having a different defense pairing on a night in, night out basis, never gets matched with somebody with consistency. You're putting him and Aho together, two defenders that are not very defensively responsible, or putting them on the ice. Two guys whose strong suit is their ability to carry the puck, distribute the puck, put the puck on net, and to be an offensive threat. We put two offensive defensemen, we pair them up together, and we think that they're going to be stalwarts on the defensive side of the puck. Are we fucking nuts?
When Dobson plays with Aho, Dobson has to be the physical force in front of the net. That is not the type of player he is. Maybe I think that's what people look at. This is what they want him to be, but that's not who he is. Yep. He's 6'4", but he's not... Scott Stevens back there.
Same
Rich Kalan or Kenny Danico. That's not his game.
Same exact thing with Brock Nelson. Big body frame, a guy who doesn't like to get physical, a guy who doesn't like to mix it up, but that's just who he is. I don't fault Brock Nelson because he's not a physical bruiser like Matt Martin or Ross Johnston, or he doesn't have the grit and determination to fight down low and mix it up like Anders Lee does. It's not his skill set. That's fine. You'd like to be see every big guy that has the ability to have the hands and the skating ability, also to have the ability and the guts to do it. Well, that's what makes a guy like that Tom Wilson or a guy like that, you know, a fantastic power forward in the NHL. Not everybody's going to be
Few of those guys.
Correct. Absolutely, Grumpy. Absolutely. Brett W. says, what's more likely, the Islanders make the playoffs or the Islanders win a round or Lou gets fired? So what's more likely, Islanders make the playoffs, the Islanders win a round, or Lou gets fired?
Islanders make the playoffs. I think the Islanders, I think they're going to do well against Detroit, Buffalo, and Pittsburgh in the next three games.
I think I misread this. What's more likely, the Islanders make the playoffs and the Islanders win a round? I don't know why you double Islanders, but the Islanders make a playoffs and win a round, or Lou gets fired?
Lou's not getting fired. So I think the first one is more likely.
Okay. He just won't be signed back. They'll just go their separate ways if they determine to do that. Andriel said, this would be a perfect episode to have Phil on.
Phil is so wrong on everything he does. It's scary. He is so wrong on everything.
I love Phil.
And he flip-flops. Believe me, he has my point of view a lot of nights. And then he changes. I think he's just a troll. I think Phil is trolling. That's what I think he does. If you look like within a day or two, he changes and he gives rational arguments for both sides.
I'm telling you, he's a flip-flop. He's a Philly flip-flop. We love Phil, but we love Phil. Hooray Chroma says, Engvall? How am I going to make a living on these deadbeats? Where'd you get this one from? The morgue? Oh, man. Shelly Grumpy. Shelly the Machine Levine. Andrew L says, make Phil a regular.
Actually, Phil, I love it when Phil's on.
I don't know. Maybe that's a lot to ask for somebody, though. You know what I mean? Like, Andrew,
we do it's so long, so many. It's a lot to ask someone to do.
Hey, Phil, do you like your family? I'm going to go ahead and take you away from them.
That might be a selling point for Mrs. Phil and the girl.
I was about to say, Mrs. Phil might like that one.
Probably, yes.
Mikey D said, hey, guys, thoughts on the trades this week? And vault to the – oh, we broke this down already. Perfect. Coach Tommy B says, good evening, gents. Happy free agency frenzy week. I tell you, it is great. It's great to see. And that's Coach Tommy B with Carson. The event went well there, the fundraiser they had for him. So great to hear that. And it was a great time with family and friends. So great to hear that, Coach Tommy B, and great to hear that, Carson. Matthew S. says, take it deep, old man. Oh, gosh, I think that was meant to you. Frank says, his upside is huge. I'm excited. I'll be at the game this Saturday. Section 112, row 3 with my daughter. Never been to UBS, so any advice with parking is appreciated. People, let him know in the comment section. Grumpy and I have no idea. We've never been to UBS Arena either yet.
And we can just blow through those comments when they come up.
Yeah, there it is. But, Frank, I hope the Islanders, even though this won't help the draft stock, I hope the Islanders win for you and your daughter. That'd be a fun experience, absolutely. What's faster, Spurgeon or a sturgeon?
I'd say Spurgeon on skates is faster than a sturgeon, which is a fish.
There it is. Oh, John Smith says, has anybody seen if CJ Loop and Power Ranger is okay? I have not seen any comments from CJ Loop and Power Ranger, Grumpy.
Newark. I heard he was going to Newark.
Oh, man. He is now has he changed to being a Devils fan?
He was wearing the Devils paraphernalia as the Red Loop and Power Ranger.
Oh my gosh, CJ. If we haven't seen from you, we're going to put a milk carton out there for CJ. Make sure he's okay after that trade. Drew L said, by the way, Chikrin went from massive haul to Ottawa earlier today. If you guys saw, I didn't think it was
I didn't think it was that much.
It was supposed to be always two first round picks, a top prospect, and a young player who's playing now.
Way less than they wound up that they were demanding for 2 years.
And Ottawa may be in a spot where they may be on the outside looking at a playoff spot. But right, Chikrin is an addition to that team. They added this year's trade deadline and for the future in a team that's very young, the Ottawa Senators.
That deal works.
Correct.
Because you got somebody who's going to be there for the long term. I mean, see, those are the type of deals. Okay, you want to give away a first round draft pick for, you know, but he's 24. He's going to be there a long time. He's a good defenseman. He makes Ottawa better. He does.
Yeah. I trust me, I don't disagree with you there, Grumpy. Got a comment here from Brett W. Hey, Islanders, got another bottom six forward. Fire Lou. Ponyberg Curtis, Grumpy.
Grumpy, I was listening to the rumor yesterday, and I heard that your favorite thing ever is when, after you get a haircut, the hair grows back, and the hair curls up on the back of your neck. That's just a nasty rumor. It's not true.
Is it true? Okay, it's not true. Freedom Fund Adventure, Grumpy.
I like the Engvall trade. Hope the Islanders resign him. Big, physical, some skill, and very fast. Him, Horvat, and Romanov are all positive. Not selling off players for assets and screwing draft position, not good. Not selling off players for assets and screwing draft position, not good. Okay, I agree. Isn't Engvall's a bottom six guy? I mean, I don't have a problem with him. For a third-round pick, I just don't know if he was needed with our current situation this year. That's all.
Mikey D.
After all these trades, who from the Metro reaches the conference final? Carolina and the Devils.
Carolina and the Devils.
I'm just going to go chalk. I'm just going to go chalk.
Okay. Nick C says, I'm okay with the trade, even though I want to say, I'm sorry, I think we already read this one. Anthony Rizzi says, I'm okay with the Islanders trade. He's only 26 with speed. Yeah, he's 27. Yeah, he'll be 27 a month, but can see Lou resigning him to be a second, a third line winger.
He's not like a second line player. He's just not.
Like, and I love when people say, like, oh, well, Toronto, that's the reason he kind of got buried. And that's not, and Drew wasn't the only person, but people have been saying that a line. Okay. Again, what does it say about your team where you have to take guys who on other teams who have talented forward groups, and you say, we're going to take your trash and we're going to treat it as a treasure, because it's not.
He's a third line guy. There's nothing wrong with that, but that's what he is. He's probably going to be, all right, think about it. Palmieri's how old? 31. Parise, 38. You got your bottom pairing guys. Martin's 32. Clutterbuck's 34. Casey is 31. I mean, they're all older players. I don't have a problem with the deal. I just wish we would move some guys to get some draft capital back. I don't have a problem adding a young guy.
Mikey D there, Grumpy.
Wish we could have superstars demand to be traded to our team like Kane, so there's no possible way for Lou to overpay. I mean, that's why the Rangers got a deal on him.
Yeah.
If Lamoriello had traded for him, it would have been two ones and a two.
I've been a handful. Romanov has been better, says Charles Dittmer. I didn't know. I'm sorry. I didn't see it last night. I haven't seen it recently either. D-Cut says, fire TJ, hire D-Cut. Oh,
no.
Anthony Rizzi says, crazy trading going on before the deadline. Yep. Nick C said, and before you guys jump on me on the age thing, he's young compared to the rest of our roster. That's true.
I don't have a problem with the. I know TJ doesn't like it, but I don't have a problem with it. It's the fact that there should be other moves included where you're moving some other guys to recoup that draft pick. I have no problem like a Engvall for Parise deal. None at all.
Anthony Rizzi said, I'm just so happy Lou didn't trade for anybody over 30 with term.
True.
Rick Roma says, you can always tell about a trade by the reaction from each fan base. The Devils fans were celebrating. San Jose fans were angry. The Leafs fans were pumped that Engvall was traded.
Well, he
not
was
not a great sign.
He was out. He's the odd man out. They brought in a couple of guys, a couple of bottom six guys, and Engvall was not even a bottom six player for them anymore. So, I mean, can he be an addition here? Yeah, he could. He wasn't going to fit in Toronto anymore, though.
Yeah.
He didn't even make it up to the big team until the last couple of years. His career NHLer.
Frank K said, great shootout team, LOL. And Tommy B says, Pierre Engvall is an interesting trade. He has upside. Gut tells me that Parise is going to retire. Yep, and this is probably that's what I was thinking too. But
see, why not move Parise? Why not? If he's going to retire and he's told you that, why not move him?
We have a handshake deal in place, Grumpy.
But why not say, Zach, do you want to have a chance to win a cup? Because you've never won one. You're never going to win one as long as you're here. So do you want to have a shot at winning a cup? Then contact teams who are contenders and say, what are you going to offer me for Parise? That's what I would do.
Grumpy.
See, that's being.
We got a handshake deal in place. We can't move him because we got another handshake deal, like last year's handshake deals.
Okay.
And that's the reason we can't sign people back, because could you imagine if Lou Lamoriello, we can't sign free agents, because if Lou Lamoriello broke a handshake deal, we wouldn't be able to sign any unrestricted free agents here to the island.
We don't sign any of them anyway.
We're going to subtract, you know, it's going to be zero. I don't know how we can get any lower than that. Steve, yes, I saw that. Thank you for sending that to me. Drew L. said, the thing for the Rangers is their cup window is very small. They only realistically have 2 to 3 years to win. If they, if not, they screwed themselves.
They only have a lot of young players. If they only have 2 to 3 years to win a cup, we got about 7 minutes.
I agree.
More skilled than we are. I don't think they're good enough to win anything now, but they could absolutely make a couple. They need defense. They need some defense. That's what they need. Their defense ain't good enough.
Point of Curtis Grumpy.
Fan fights are the best. Can you guys do an in-depth analysis of the February 2011 game against the Penguins where we physically annihilated and destroyed them? No.
I think we've actually done that before. Maybe we'll have to circle back on that one. Josh Bailey to Nashville. Get it done, says Brett. Dale S. says, this is a good trade if you can re-sign him.
Yeah, I have no problem. TJ hates a deal. I don't hate it.
Here's the thing. It's not the right move.
You're right. It's not the right move.
I don't mind the player. And you look at it on paper with no context and you say third round pick for Engvall at the trade deadline. You say, okay, gotcha. That's fine. I don't have an issue with it. But when we look at the team and the consistent hole we continue to dig ourselves in, I'm like, oh, great. The repeating pattern is back once again, digging ourselves to freaking China with how large this hole is getting.
I would have felt better if this was a deal that the Islanders made 3 years ago, not necessarily for Engvall, but for an Engvall type player.
Sure.
Three years ago, something like that.
On the cusp with a lot closer. We felt like, oh, wow, we have a chance. I didn't mind the addition of guys like Andy Green. I didn't mind the addition of guys like that when we were trying to go after a cup. Didn't mind that. Anthony Rizzi says, TJ, I think we are safe. There's no one left for Lou to screw us on. That's the only hope we have. There's nobody left.
There you go. Well, I mean, they're talking about, you know, James Van Riemsdyk is one of the big guys left. You couldn't give him away in the offseason.
Correct.
He could not be given away. Now he's the top guy left available, you know, who could be moved. I'm like, it tells me everybody else is already gone.
Yep. Frank says, I worry because some Leafs fan says he's soft. Oh, God.
Well, you know what? I'm going to watch him for a while before I make a judgment.
Sure. I'm right there with you. The chicken trade wasn't as bad as I thought it would be. I definitely would have given Arizona the same package. Everybody but TJ knows Grump is the star of the show.
True.
Hold on. Did I say you were not the star of the show?
I don't know.
D-Cut says, no coincidence. Romanoff playing better. Oh, no. Romanoff playing better since he's been moved with Pollock. Dobson was dragging him down. I'll tell you one thing. D-Cut's damn lost his mind too. These fans, Grumpy, I'll tell you, Romanoff looked miserable last night, too. Absolutely miserable. Miserable. I mean, I don't know how many times I could see him covering and abandoning his assignment on a consistent basis and say, that looks good. At this point, it's just like, why continue to complain about the same exact thing when it's just going to be the same thing and it's never going to change? Romanoff has no defensive responsibility. Nick C said, I was talking to my buddy during the game last night. I told him, I could bet how many times Aho would fall over skates. I take the over every single time.
So that's the guy that Dobson's paired with, the guy who can't stay on his feet, and people are blaming Dobson. Okay.
Drew L. said, no, TJ Grumpy.
Grumpy did say that they weren't going to be any major moves. Grumpy is right in that regard. That's what I said.
Grumpy also said multiple times we were not making any other trades. We have nothing left of value to trade. We're not making any trades. I told you multiple times that we're going to trade for an ancillary piece, a smaller piece, and you told me I was wrong. I'll pull it back up. You're wrong, Grumpy. You're wrong. Hunter Curtis said, TJ, never answer my question for the other podcast. I want both of you guys' answers. Who is the ringleader, vice president, treasurer, and secretary of the Colts?
We did answer that question.
I say, point of Curtis. Anders Lee, ringleader, vice president, Josh Bailey. I'm going to say secretary is Cal Clutterbuck, and Matt Martin is the treasurer because they'll beat you up if you don't pay your dues.
Oh, okay. I like that.
There you go. Frank says here, I'm so psyched, guys. We go to the game on Saturday. So is my daughter. I've been tingling all day.
I hope she has a great – I don't care about you, Frank, but I hope your daughter has a great time.
I hope they win for you. Ariel C says here, why are you guys mad about the Engvall trade? It's a third-round pick. He's a solid bottom six forward that's young and fast.
He's young-ish. He's not young anymore.
He's in the prime of his career.
Yeah. So I don't have a problem with it. TJ is the one who had a problem with it, not me. I just for me.
We should all have a problem with this trade. Was he a free agent on July 1st, or did I forget something?
All I'm saying is, if you move Parise, the problem I have is you could have done something in conjuncture that helps the team going forward and keeps it where it is now.
But my thing is this. He was going to be a free agent on July 1st. The only reason you make this trade is because you want to sign him to, but you think he's so crucial to your piece of winning a Stanley Cup.
And
why do you need him 4 or 5 months early? Why do you need him 5 months early or 4 months early?
Here's another thing to strengthen your case, TJ. He was going to be a healthy scratch the rest of the year.
My point exactly. What do you think he was going to be getting paid as a guy who's healthy? He would have been traded, right?
So
he definitely would have been traded somewhere. But you could have had – he's a bottom six NHLer. Guys like that, they don't say, oh, man, we've got to get signed back. We got to give him an 8-year extension. No. He's able to test the market. He would have been fine doing that. And we don't even know if we're going to sign his ass back. We don't even know that, but I would assume we do.
I'm going to assume we do also.
Lou has fucked this team real deep. Yes, he has. Aho is god-awful, says Coach Tommy B. He struggled recently. He has. Nick D says, TJ Grumpy, how you doing tonight? TSN and Sportsnet are just going to fill in time on Friday. Nothing else will happen. Hornick to Vancouver, and Detroit gets the pick that got us Bo Horvat.
Yep. Man, that's a kick in the teeth right there. TJ's team, the Red Wings.
Yeah! You know what? Peter paid Paul, baby. I was happy the Islanders traded that away. I wish I would have gave up more so my boys, the Detroit Red Wings, would have picked up more draft capital.
I hope whoever they pick turns out to be a freaking bust so we can say, well, at least it would have been a bust for the Islanders too.
Oh, man. I hope they turn out to be a Hall of Fame. Wouldn't that just be Islanders? The guy turns out to be a Hall of Famer. Oh, and the Detroit Red Wings select at the 14th overall pick. Henrik said, you know, the second coming of Datsyuk, or the second coming of Zetterberg, and the guy makes the Hall of Fame. We're just saying, we could have had him, but we traded him away. We traded that pick away. Anyway, Drew said, the difference is with Engvall is personally, at least to me, he still has some untapped potential. How much potential does a 27-year-old have?
Maybe he'll be a 15-goal scorer. By the way, is Andy Francis coming on Saturday?
No, Wednesday, next Wednesday. And then after that, we'll have Ariel on the next Wednesday. So this next Wednesday could be Andy Francis. The Wednesday after that, Ariel's going
to
be on.
I just wanted to know because he said 7, potentially 8, 20 goal scorers. We have 2 with 18 games to go.
Goon says a third round pick in the 2024 NHL draft. Lou's learning. At least he didn't trade a first round pick for last 6 mils rookie card.
Very true. Very true.
Don't get my last things millage card out there, Goon. You know what? That would be worth it. Maybe a first round pick for that card. Oh, no doubt. Lou would have won the deal then. Fire lame, says D-Cut. Ariel also says Dobson is awful defensively, guys. I honestly think we should try. I think maybe we should try him at forward.
No.
That's not even being funny.
People used to say that about Ron Gresham when he was playing defense for the Rangers. No. He's a defenseman. Put him with a solid defensive partner and watch his game. He should be with Pelech.
Yes.
He should be with Pelech.
Most talented offensive defenseman should be with their most talented defensive defenseman. So where they offset and you have a cohesive unit on the ice.
That's what they should do.
Hey, Dobson, you're joining the rush on every single situation. Pelech is staying back and sitting and staying home.
I'm going to tell you what. To me, the two worst defenders on this team are Aho and Romanov.
Romanov's awful. He's the worst defender.
For different reasons. Romanov, just because... he's skating around with his head in the clouds. And Aho, because he's just too small. But, I mean, he's the puck mover. That's why I kind of like Aho with Mayfield. Put Pulak with Romanov. You're not going to see production. Look at how bad Pulak's going to look. I remember early in the year they together. It was the worst Pulak looked all year. Because that's what happens when you have to cover for your partner all the time.
Yep. Basically, give us your individual Mount Rushmores of the cul-de-sac crew, is what Hunter Hurd said. Frank says, yes, Drew, exactly. He's fast. With my daughter being at the game, he'll score on Saturday. Watch. Goon said, how much money will it take for you to name your first child Lastings? Everybody has a price. Name it. A lot. A lot. A lot. $20 million. I don't know.
Oh, Jesus
Christ. Tony Bacardis. Grumpy, what would it take for you to name, to go back, take the clock back and name Son X Lastings? How much would that would have cost you? How
Why
much
would I name Son X Lastings?
That's the question that was posed.
Well, that's you. I have no connection to Lastings at all. None.
Pornberger says he puts up the same amount of points as Josh Bailey and half the ice time. Woohoo!
Okay, that's not really a Josh Bailey blows. If you're comparing him to Josh Bailey, I really don't like the trade now.
That's the only way that we can win is if we compare him to Josh Bailey. Goon says, TJ and Grumpy, did Bailey prove you wrong last night?
No, but I'm going to tell you what, that was a nice goal. He did a nice little kick with the skate to get it onto his stick. That was a nice play by Josh Bailey. He went somewhere where no one has gone before, as I said in Star Trek Enterprise, right towards the front of the net, which is not something he normally does. But I thought it was a nice goal by him.
Every once in a while, he'll have a fantastic move that just kind of gets you saying, holy shit, he can do that? That's exactly what happens. Errol C said, we need bottom six talent as well. Clutter and Martin won't be here forever. Well, but, see, the thing is, you have guys like Durando. You have guys, right, Durando, the two games we played, so many Islander fans, listeners to this show too, said, wow, kind of was upset he didn't get out there. I mean, like, we didn't play, you know, Durando, because we didn't have any spots available for him. Durando has played well. He's played well. We didn't play Durando because Ross Johnson had to go out there. We have young guys who can play a bottom six role, but when we have to feel like we've got to pay $3 million for a veteran to play a bottom six role instead of a young energy guy, it's the reason why we don't have any cap space.
We picked up Hudson Fashing.
Damn it, Grumpy. All the time, Hunter. Hudson Fashing, Grumpy.
We picked up Fashing this year off the scrap heap. He's correct. Been fine. Better than fine. You don't need to pay for bottom six guys. Certainly, you just don't. That's what the young guys are for. Let them cut their teeth. Let them show hustle.
Oh, hold on a second. This is a good one. This is sent by Tony Cheese, Grumpy. We do have a picture of Lastings Millage, my Lastings Millage rookie card, Grumpy. And I'll tell you, for those unaffiliated, it's a beaut. Look at this Lastings Millage rookie card, Grumpy.
Okay.
Notice who's in the middle of that picture?
Oh, it looks like
E.D. Cooper, defensive back Cooper, Grumpy.
Defensive back Cooper.
Defensive back Cooper photoshopped on top of a Lastings Millage card. Isn't that beautiful? Wow. Oh, looky. I
wonder what the value of that card is.
Oh, that card right there, probably hundreds of millions of dollars, Grump. That's one you have to save up for your entire lifetime.
Okay.
Thank you there for that, Tony Cheese. But you know, we talk about too that trade for Horvat. You know, I think Horvat's a fantastic player. Again, like I have my feelings and opinions on it, but isn't it just crazy? Anthony Beauvillier is playing some of the better hockey we've seen out of him, and I don't know, since that
rookie entire career.
Yeah, I was about to say 11 games played, 11 points, 6 goals, and 5 assists for Anthony Beauvillier.
Good for him.
Yeah, playing well. Let me ask you this. Anthony Beauvillier puts up good numbers. Again, he's paired up with Elias Pettersson, but hey, he's scoring goals. It's not like he's just assisting or as a sidecar. He's scoring goals. He's putting the puck in the net. But let's assume he puts up points. I think that trade's going to be looked back on in retrospect saying, wow, the Islanders got fleeced. Remember, Vancouver plays a modern style of NHL hockey. Heavy forecheck, skating is needed. We play an opposite style of hockey to that. Skating is not paramount. We do not play the modern style of hockey. We're trying to make that transition, but we don't have the guys in order to do that.
Who has more points, Beauvillier or Horvat?
Beauvillier has more points than Horvat. Horvat's played more games, I believe, too.
Okay.
Yep. What were you going to try to say? Is that you're going to try to double down and say, Bo Horvat, fantastic? No. Here's the thing. I'm not trying to shit on Horvat. Horvat's been great. He's an extremely talented player. He, you know, he was averaging more points per game, right, than Anthony Bevilia was when he was in Vancouver, and they're completely different situations. I'm just saying, Anthony Bevilia, we traded a guy at his lowest point and gave up freaking – we got essentially – we traded away a guy at his lowest point and got freaking peanuts for him. It's just poor management of an asset, because when you see him go to Vancouver and he's put in the right situation, you say, oh, wow, 11 games is a short sample size, but he's got 6 goals and 5 assists in 11 games. You say, yeah, maybe we didn't trade him at the right time. Maybe we kind of screwed up on that, giving away Pavilion. Maybe we undervalued him too.
No, he was never going to produce for us, period. He needed a change of scenery.
I think he needed to change his scenery too. I'm just saying, we traded a guy at his lowest value. If we traded him last year, his value was higher. We traded him 2 years ago, his value was higher. 3 years ago, his value was higher. Every single year, he's had more value than this year when we traded him. We traded him at his lowest point. And now he's like, hey, we're going to revamp up that value again because I'm in a situation with a change of scenery where I'm playing better with better line mates.
Here's the thing. He was never going to be – his value was never going to be any higher for the Islanders than it was at the end. Because it just wasn't going to work here.
You should have been proactive and moved him earlier. Okay. Is my point. If you were hell-bent on that being a guy who was exposable and expendable.
They wanted it to work out. It just didn't. That's what I feel.
Okay. Let's see here. Oops.
I'm not going to rip Lamoriello for trading him. First round pick, yeah. Yeah. But Horvat, for me, I mean, he's – top six forward that we've been clamoring for years. And we got one.
Wrong philosophy, though. Okay, I'm trying to get this. Oh, D-Cut Grumpy.
Breaking news. D-Cut and Phil's Facts have called a truce and are having productive Isles chats. Watch out. He's a freaking snake. It's like you're dealing with Putin over there, D-Cut. Watch your step.
Pointer says, TJ, how much would it take you to name your first child Grumpy Bailey? a lot. Better than sleeping pills, says Coach Tommy B. First name Grumpy, middle name Bailey, last name X.
Oh,
son X. Okay. 3-1-1 without the ballerina. Trade him and Dobson before July 1st.
Okay. Right. Trade him. Also, Detroit signed Dylan Larkin back today.
Yeah. Good for that.
8 years, $69.7 million. So whatever that comes out to.
Nick C. Grumpy.
Before you guys blow your load on a third-round pick, third-round picks have about 10% chance of you making the NHL, not to mention to be an elite player. We got a youngish forward who can play now. He's a bottom six point. He's a bottom six guy. I mean, say that to Anders Lee. Say that to Casey Cizikas. Right? I mean... Sure. Most of our good draft picks are later rounds.
Who was Sorokin picked? Third round pick, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Hey, get rid of him. Get rid of the third round picks. We don't need it. Hey, when you hit on a third round pick and you roll across the Sorokin, you say, holy shit, that can completely change the freaking, that can completely alter the freaking future of the team.
I'll tell you what.
That's what happens.
Here's what I want to say to Nick. Nick, here's the thing. It's not just a third round pick. You can pack, if you have enough picks, you can package to move up to select a player you want. Or you could, I mean, or you could package other picks to, you know, trade for another piece. When you keep on trading all your picks on guys who, he's a bottom six guy. You can't sell it any more than that. He's a bottom sixer, right? Look at this draft.
Third round pick Sorokin. Think about this. Two first round picks, both busts. But we outweigh a shitty first round that year with finding a guy who's a top five goalie in the NHL. Third round. We go ahead and find a guy, Devon Taves, who receives Norris Trophy votes in the fourth round. Those two picks alone salvage a draft where you can miss on every other selection. It's that simple. You're going to have years where it's like, oh, we don't get anybody but Pulak.
There's a zero. Pulak,
right? Okay. Oh, Pelech, third round pick, Adam Pelech.
Right. Don't need that.
Third round pick, Adam Pelech.
And he's the only one who panned out in the whole draft.
And you go years, hey, we don't have
Mayfield. Second round pick.
Yep. But you could pair up a second, a mid-second round pick, and your third round pick to move up to that early second round spot to get your guys like that.
And that's right here. That's a draft where they, I think they packaged something with a third round pick to go up and get Nelson at the end of the first round.
They did. They came and traded back into the first round to get Brock Nelson. That was a, that was one where you had to trade back in to get him. Casey Zizekas, fourth round pick. Anders Lee. Think about this. Let's just look at the years. Years that are hits in the third or later selection since 2014 on. Right? We could go scroll
over. Why don't we look at our first and second round picks and then all the rest?
And we could do that year by year, right? You're going to have some years where it's like, hey, Marzal, Bevilier, and nothing else, right? But I want to make sure we're not going to say, hey, let's go all the way to 2020. I mean, these guys are still relatively young drafted in that 2018 draft class. I mean, you didn't hit Sebastian Aho, plays an everyday role for the NHL, for the Islanders, fifth round pick, nothing in the first round. Bellows doesn't do anything. Koivula doesn't do anything. We didn't get a single player in this year's draft class that did it. Okay, great. Marzal, Bevilier, nobody else. 2014.
Sorokin and Taves, nobody else.
So there you go. We've got 1 year already. Fantastic. Fantastic late round picks.
Just a first round pick in Pulak.
Yep. Pelech.
Just a third
round pick. Fantastic third round pick. Mm-hmm. Second round pick in Mayfield.
And Strome was good too. So a first and a second. That's it.
Yep. Brock Nelson, you don't need first a runner.
Two ones. Yep. One that we had to use assets to trade up to get.
Yeah.
Now, here's Koskinen is still a player.
Koskinen, yeah.
I mean, is Nilsson still in the league? I don't know. But Casey Zizekas and Anders Lee. I mean, that was a good draft. 2009 was a good draft for the
Koskinen, NBA. Actually, he was in the league last year no longer. He was with the Edmonton Oilers last year. He's gone now. But, yeah, Lee, sixth-round pick, Zizekas. The reason we're bringing this up is because you can find talented players later on in the draft.
Nobody, no one. In Jared Spurgeon, he's the only, and Matt Martin.
Matt Martin and Travis Hamonic.
No one else panned out.
Bailey panned out?
No way. Yeah, Bailey. Okay, but there again, you got a guys in the fifth and the sixth round. But
this is the point. This year's draft class is supposed, and this, I know we traded next year's selection too, but this year's draft class is supposed to be generational talent, and we've already given up our third round pick this year. We gave up our first round pick in all likelihood, and they're just kind of like, great, continue chugging along, right?
Well, we don't know if you go really go much back. All right, you got Okposo, who was a player, and that's and
McDonald.
And Andrew McDonald was good.
Played too. Like 586 games. My point is you can find players later in the draft and players that have played on this team for long time periods that have been successful that were later than third-round picks just to treat it like, ah, don't worry about it. It's just a third-round pick. Well, what if we did that with Sorokin? If we did that with Sorokin, we'd be one of the worst teams in the NHL right now. Anyway, was Brock Besser traded? No, he was not.
Not yet.
The Kings did Jonathan Quick dirty, trading him on the plane flight back to LA to Columbus.
Yeah.
Donuts. Yikes.
They went, you know, he and Kopitar and Brown and Doughty, they went through the tough times after winning the cup and, you know, they were teaching a lot of the young guys how to play. And then just as they start getting good again, they dump them. I don't blame them because I think he's kind of finished.
It's a business, not a friendship.
Yeah, I know, but that's kind of tough. I think it's kind of tough.
It's a business, not a friendship. They understand that. Yeah. They understand that. They've been a professional for how many years? You've been playing like dog shit this year. I'm glad you've helped us out, but I can't keep players on team for sentimental reasons.
Yeah.
I can't keep guys who don't perform for sentimental reasons. I'm sorry. I can't sign back Kyle Clutterbuck for sentimental reasons because he's part of the best fourth line in hockey. When he's not freaking doing the trick anymore, he can't be there. Sorry. Goon said, look at it this way. If the Islanders make the playoffs, at least they will be no longer be subjected to the 3-on-3 or shootouts.
Well, what makes you think we're even going overtime?
Go, Grumpy.
We play Boston or Carolina. Those are regulation.
Grumpy, losses. Anthony R. Grumpy.
You're right, Grumpy. Not anything crazy, but I think he replaces guys like Parise and whoever's on the third line. We aren't going to get a top scorer during the deadline. Exactly.
And hopefully that comes in the offseason.
It won't.
I'm one like you, not to trade away picks right now, but willing for a third round 2024 pick for a guy with size, speed, and talent.
I don't think he's really talented.
Wow, we are selling the hell out of this guy. Do you remember when everybody was talking about Romanoff? Oh, he's so great. He moves the puck, got a lot of offensive growth. He lays the body. The best defenseman on Montreal at 22 years old.
he's a bottom six guy. That's what he is. He'll pop, you know, 10, 12, 15, maybe in a good year, 15 goals. He's a third liner. That's what he is. Nothing wrong with that. It's what he is. I just wish we'd move Parise and recoup that third rounder. That's all. That'd make me feel, I'd feel great about it then. I have no problem with him replacing Parise. The fact is we didn't have to give up a third round pick for him because his value was going to be down. His value was going to be way down.
Whatever Curtis says here, I didn't think it was a boring game. I thought it was pretty legit.
Oh, my God. There's no
Christmas.
Way.
Christmas.
Playing for shootout.
Why are there so many trades this year? I think you, Grumpy, answered it too earlier. Everybody looks at Boston, how fantastic they are, and they say, if we want to compete this year, we have to be on that level.
Yep.
John Smith said, Holmstrom, Bailey, and Johnston cannot stay on this team if they're serious about the playoffs.
Okay, I'm going to put it, Holmstrom's not going anywhere.
Correct.
Neither is Bailey and neither is Johnston. I don't think you're not going to see anybody moved off this team. When was the last time he got rid of anybody off this team?
Ariel C said, if anybody gives Dobson $10 million per year, they should be taken behind a shed. And oh, you know what?
Oh, wow. TJ said he's going to get $10 million a year. I said, no way.
That's correct. You will be getting $10 million a year.
But you know what? Andy Francis is getting a Dobson 10 mil shirt, though.
Hey, he's got to get it. He's got to get it. Grumpy, maybe he'll release it. Maybe he'll bring it out on that show Wednesday. D-Cut says, Trotson road trip, 3 points and only gave up one goal in two games.
Okay, yeah.
Okay, let's ask about that. Because people are saying, oh, guys, that Winnipeg game, we played a real great hockey game. We did this, we did that, fantastic. Winnipeg has won one of their last seven games. Winnipeg has been abysmal lately. We took care of a team that was struggling and playing like shit, as you have to do. You only play the teams in front of you. But I did see people online were like celebrating that Winnipeg win, like, oh, but we're back. We're playing defensive structured. We beat a team that collapsed in Winnipeg. They collapsed, and they've been collapsing all week. They had a 3-goal lead last night, I believe, and they lost in overtime to the Kings.
Yeah, and Minnesota's moving, guys.
I've never seen this many trades, says Chris Smith.
It's true. It's true. I before deadline. Like I said, I think trade deadline is going to be, it's going to not be great. There's not a whole lot of guys left to move.
Got a comment here from Michael Watts saying, Horvat trade looks decent with what other teams are paying, especially since he signed long-term. I mean, like, I'm just saying we undervalued what we saw in Bavillier. Bavillier's got 11 points in 11 games with Vancouver. We look at him as just like, man, we're putting him in there. Let me ask you this, Grumpy. If Bavillier goes on to a successful career with Vancouver, and let's say he puts up 55 to 60 points a year because he plays with Elias Pettersson, are we saying, that was just a meh piece we threw in there? No, we're saying, Jesus Christ, unfortunately, we couldn't have him. We had to give him away for freaking pennies on the side.
But he was never going to do that here.
I understand that. He was never going to do that because of the team and the cast and crew we had around him. That's correct.
Okay. At the end of the day, he needed to change the scenery.
I understand. I understand he needed to change the scenery. I said it worked out both best for all parties. Here's the thing, though, Grumpy. Holy shit. We trade him at his lowest point where he has more value than that. He has more value than that. And if he proves that he's got more value and we gave him away from freaking pennies, that shows that we don't know how to manage an asset again.
He was a depressed asset because he wasn't going to work out here. I don't. There was
held on to him like this when we knew his freaking playing style wasn't best suited for this freaking style that we play.
I disagree. We'll just agree to disagree on that because I don't think there was anything we could have ever done to make his value more than it was.
Trade you always said
he's nothing more than a third liner. That's right out of your mouth. He's
nothing more than a streaky third line guy. On our team, that's correct. On our team, that is 100% correct. He's not on our team anymore. Okay. We should have traded him away immediately as soon as we came to that realization, not held on to him and let the rest of the freaking league see he was a third-line guy.
Okay.
Because I guess on other teams, he plays a different role, and he's more successful on the ice. Anyway, Anthony Rizzi, Grumpy.
We aren't making the playoffs. I think Pittsburgh and maybe Ottawa makes it. I think Detroit takes a step back with them trading a top four D-man for a first-rounder and a second-rounder. And the worst thing is, it's our first rounder. Ugh.
We have to win 12 out of the next 18 games to make the playoffs.
It's possible. Here's the thing. We just have to get hot. I mean, I think we could win 2 out of every 3 games. Here's the thing. The next four games are pivotal. They're all teams. I'm going to include Washington, even though, I mean, they're only like, I think, 4 points behind us.
Washington, yeah, they're four. They played tonight against the Ducks. They are a few points behind us, but they played tonight against the Ducks, and they have two games in hand.
Okay. So let's lump them in there, too. Those are four teams that you're battling with directly for that final two playoff spots. If you can beat all those four teams, we're going to the playoffs. I'm going to tell you right now. If you split, it's dicey because they, particularly Pittsburgh, Detroit, and Buffalo all have like four or five games in hand. But they have to win. Like I said, the problem with Detroit and Buffalo is the same thing. They're young.
Pittsburgh is 6 points behind us with two games in hand.
Pittsburgh is 6 points behind
I'm sorry. Washington, 2 points or two games in hand, 6 points behind.
Okay. But we play them, what, three times in the last month? Yes, so, I mean, those are four-point games.
That's a team that could very easily get hot. People are writing them off. You cannot write off the Washington Capitals. Simple. The misery is brutal, guys. The trade was not bad at all.
I don't know why Ariel is lumping me in with you.
I don't know how we're happy about that trade.
I.
Why should we be happy about that trade?
It's just moving chairs on the Titanic.
Why are we moving chairs on a Titanic, but just throwing a third round pick in the trash then?
Well,
that's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. Explain to me how this is a good trade. Explain to me why I should be excited about this trade. Oh, he's got upside. The 27-year-old forward who was the odd man out in Toronto has upside to play in a top six role for us. Wow.
For me, it's a meh trade. Okay. He replaces Parise. Move Parise then. Move him at the deadline. Recoup that third round pick. I'd feel much better. I'm like, okay, it's fine.
Gungu says, was it just me or should the refs have taken another look at the Reeves stick? Was it too high on the goal he scored? No, I didn't think so.
No.
He waited. I mean, that was a beautiful play by him. That was his first goal of the season, which was hard to believe. Engvall will be a first liner on this team.
Now, that's possible. That's possible.
Wow. Mm. Christmas said, I think they'll get the fifth seed.
Who?
It must be for earlier.
Okay.
Dmitry Kulikov is our next get, says Alana Vital.
He's finished.
Let's see here. I wonder if It's Dazed is here from the last podcast. Oh, I can't wait till he says something. Oh, yeah, that's right. Pitt just got Mikael Granlund. That's a good trade for them, too. They're a team that is in win-now mode with a whole bunch of old players they have got to try to do. Right? If Pittsburgh doesn't win a cup this year, they should rebuild.
It's not going to matter. I don't care who they add. They're not winning a Stanley Cup. They might get into the playoffs. That's it. Pittsburgh's not winning a Stanley Cup. That's why it's like, oh, you listen to Islander fans. Oh, you know, we can make a run. Well, you could say that about any team, but realistically, none of the teams who are competing for those two wildcard spots are going to make a run. They're just not that good. Sorry. Mm-hmm. And all of them, every single one of them.
Freedom Fund Adventure, Grumpy.
Next season, potential forward group. Left wing, ? Horvat and Barzal. I agree. Lee, Nelson, and Wallstrom. We'll see. Engvall, Pajot, and Palmieri. Johnson, Casey, and Martin. Extras, Durando, Holmstrom, some others. Holmstrom's going to be playing every game.
Yes.
And guess what? So's your buddy Bailey. I hate to tell you.
Yes. I mean, it's just that's why when we trade for a guy like that, I'm like, we liked what we saw in Durando, didn't we? It was two games, albeit. Were we excited about what we saw in Durando? Yes. I liked what I saw in that kid.
He brought energy.
We trade for people like Engvall. We don't have any bottom six spots to have open for a guy like Durando.
Why no Fashing? Why not Fashing?
Fashing's on this list.
He should be playing in there. I mean, just
we have so many bottom six forwards. Just, we don't have any room for him, but we still fucking trade for bottom six forwards.
It's a team of bottom six forwards. I mean, I don't know.
It's the wrong philosophy that keeps us on the treadmill of freaking mediocrity. And we say, yeah, I like running on this treadmill forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. And I don't realize we're just standing in place.
I like the hamster wheel better.
How's it go, Grumpy? AJ Piazza says, oh, I'm not related to the Mike Piazza, but also go Yankees. Okay. Oh, AJ, if you were, we're going to have to ask for Mike Piazza to send us an apology or send me an apology. Coach Tommy B says, yeah, it's a crucial four. This is a crucial 4-2-1 stretch. Just gave us a decent chance of making the playoffs, especially with the Caps. I don't think the Caps have mailed it in.
Sandin was a good pickup for them.
That's a piece that helps them now and down the road.
Yeah.
People are like, oh, they lost Orlov. Yeah, sure. But, I mean, Sandin's an important piece, too, that can help them out.
Guy 10 years younger. Is he as good as Orlov now? No. But he certainly has a potential to be. And he was the odd man out in Toronto. I mean, don't we play Toronto before the end of the season?
Yes, we do play
them. We ain't beating them. We should pull up the schedule and just count the losses.
Oh, we'll do that later.
Because they're not losing to Tampa. I think we play Tampa twice. Those are two losses.
Give me a second here. Okay. Popping up. Payne's just traded second-round pick for Gremlin. Joseph C. Grumpy.
Meyer to the Devils is a hell of a move by Jersey. I hate that team so much. Yeah, it was a good. That was a good move by Jersey. I know that Carolina wanted him to.
Mm. Got a comment here from Drew L.
All I know is the Nets had a top two defense. What top two defense? That's talking about basketball.
Do you think Engvall gets an extension?
Why not? I'm sure he will. Probably with a full no trade clause, no move clause for a bottom six guy. That's the type of deals we give out. I'd give him 3 years.
Okay, really quickly, Mikael Grundlin has still 2 years remaining on his contract, making $5 million a year. That wasn't a rental they gave up a second-round pick for. I mean, like, right? Mikael Grundlin. He's a playmaker.
Grundlin's a better player than Engvall.
Yes, absolutely he is.
And he's got under team control for another 2 years.
After this season.
I mean, that's a better – I would rather trade a second for Grundlin than I would a third for Engvall.
That's my point. Grundlin addresses the need. We don't have playmakers on this team. We don't. He's a guy who adds versatility, a guy who still skates like the wind, who's making $5 million a year over the next 2 years. Second round pick. TJ with the horrible Linkin Park. Oh, imitation. Thank you. Synergy HD says Linkin Park. Anyway, Guggen says, Grumpy, are you feeling better? Back to full strength. If so, show us how many more dance moves to prove your sense of rhythm has returned.
I am feeling much better. Not 100%, but close enough for government work. But no dancing today. That's strictly for TJ and Grumpy Old Man Show.
That's tomorrow, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. A link in the description below. Frank says here, why are the Islanders so freaking bad at penalty shots? What the fuck do they need to do? Do they need to practice on? I hate the slow approach. Come in fast. WTF. Okay, penalty shots are not all talent and skill-based, but when you have talent and skill and your stick is almost like an extension of your arm because you could stick handle and you're that natural with the puck, it helps scoring goals and shootout. We don't have enough guys like that.
I disagree. I think they're strictly talent and skill based. That's why it's a skill. You have to have good hands. If you don't have good hands, it's not going to work.
Did you see Goudreau's freaking penalty shot last night that scored? I was like, holy shit. That, like, you look at the way he moved, I'm like, that is a hell of a freaking penalty shot. And they talked about it. He's like one of the best penalty shooters on that team. That's what they're talking about in that Minnesota broadcast. D-Cut says, McDavid with number 51 tonight. Coach Tommy B says, courage for Carson. Sunday was a huge success. Thanks for myself and Drive for Five. To TJ and Grumpy Man for promoting the event and the show. Much appreciated. Thank you, Coach Tommy B. Glad that went well and that the Courage for Carson's day on Sunday went well. Glad to hear that, Coach Tommy B. Joseph C. Grumpy.
Sucks because the Devils have so much young talent that they didn't have to give up any of, that they can afford to give Meyer $9 million a year and still won't be cap crunch. I don't think he's going to get $9 million a year.
He's going to get a good bit.
Yeah, yeah,
but David scored two tonight, 2 goals and an assist.
Oh, yeah, the Devils are beating the hell out of Colorado.
Yep.
5-1. They're good. They're freaking good. I was so wrong on them this year, 100% wrong.
I told you, maybe they'd sneak in, but I was wrong too.
I couldn't have been more wrong on the Devils. I remember I thought losing to the Devils at the beginning of my end, that's a bad loss for us. Nope, it sure wasn't. They're better than we are.
Yeah.
Who'd rather be the Devils or us?
The Devils.
The Rangers.
Frank, the Rangers.
Buffalo or us?
Buffalo. The Detroit Red Wings. Or us? The Red Wings.
Ottawa or us?
Ottawa. The list goes on and on. Yeah, I'd rather Ottawa be Ottawa. What?
But they're young. Ottawa doesn't have a goalie, but they're young. Chicken was a big, good. What a pickup for them.
Huge pickup for them.
Frank, yeah. Empire State says, no one has mentioned this yet, but I noticed the Islanders signed their minor league goalie. True.
Christian Lennox.
Lennox. Does this mean that Varley being traded, one of the goalie trades, was crazy so we can get a King's ransom for Varley? Absolutely. I mean, it's I for the life of me, I don't know what Lamoriello's thinking. Varlamov is a backup.
And was he grumpy?
He's a freaking backup. He doesn't play.
A backup.
Move him. Get a first round pick. I feel better about everything that we did so far in the season if we got a first round pick back.
I would
so too. Much better.
I would too. I said again, I wouldn't have minded the Horvat trade if we traded away players on expiring deals. We yes. tried to address issues that we have had in the past and issues that are going to still be here, while also still making sure that we keep in mind the future of this team too.
That's right. I mean, like I said, everyone knows I love Bo Horvat.
Yes.
So it's like, okay, we overpaid. I didn't want to give a first round pick, whatever. But if you get yourself and move Mayfield. Move Parise. If you get two ones and a three, man, then you know what? A plus for Lou Lamoriello. Because that's what Washington's doing.
Yeah.
And that's, you know what? Lamoriello got better in the short term and the long term.
Correct.
That's what it means. Okay, where Horvat is better, one of our top six forwards, without a doubt, right? Top two forward now with sure. Barzal out, right? No problem there sure. at all. That's we've been clamoring for that. And now you have draft picks and you just lost guys that you weren't going to bring back. Or let's say you want to bring them back. So what? You can contact them in the offseason. They're all going to hit free agency. What does it matter? And you get draft picks. That to me, it's like what Washington has done. Good moves by Washington. We could have done the same thing. Why not?
I know everybody's hyping the Rangers for getting Kane.
But
did you read this?
No. I'm sorry. No.
They fixed any of the holes. They still don't have good defense with Igor struggling. And they mortgaged the future for two rentals.
They didn't really mortgage the future. They got a lot of young guys on that team too.
I got to pull up their draft pick history because I'm not too familiar with the Rangers draft pick history. I mean, like they've had, okay. They still have young players on this team. Yeah, like I know Lafreniere is like, oh, Lafreniere's a bust. He's this, he's that. He's 21 years old.
Yeah. How old's Kako?
Was he going to be 20? Like 22? Let me pull up here. He's 22.
Okay.
31 points in 61 games. Yeah, you know, he's 22 years old.
Here's
is he going to be, you know, your prototypical stud franchise caliber guy? No, but he's still going to contribute on that.
But here's the thing. They have no possibility of breaking the top two lines.
Correct. And that's a guy who has value you could trade for draft capital because he's young, and you could make the argument because of the pedigree first off. The pedigree helps, but he's also put up points consistently on that team. You could trade a guy like that. He has value.
Yep.
He's not part of the answer. Goon, grumpy.
No Brock last night of the shootout. He's not really good in shootouts, though. That Holmstrom attempt was the saddest thing ever, almost akin to the fan fight when the mullet boy was called Little Boy and his hair gently petted. Was that the one that we got bounced for? Was that?
Yes.
That was nothing.
I know. But they don't mess around with that on YouTube anymore, man.
I liked it when Paul Bunyan beat the hell out of Mullet Boy.
And the guy said, hey, little boy, and just softly touched
his little boy. And combed his little hair a little bit for him?
Freedom Fun Adventure, Grumpy.
I can appreciate the three acquisitions this year. Three? Did we make three? But if Lou doesn't sell, then he has mismanaged organizational assets and the trade deadline 2 years in a row. If Lou sells, would you improve his grade? Absolutely. Yes. We just talked about it. Yep. If he moves the UFAs and he gets a couple of ones and a two or a couple of ones and a three, that's an A+. Then he is built for the future while making the present team better. That's what a GM should do.
Correct.
But
the sad truth is he's an 80-year-old man.
Yep. He doesn't have his fastball anymore. You can't expect him to have his fastball. He's living by on guile and reputation. That's
it. Rick Roma, Grumpy.
Devils traded Hall for Kevin Ball, a first, which became Dawson Mercer, and a second, which they traded for Jonas Siegenthaler. Collect picks and draft well. That's how it's done. Absolutely.
Yeah, Dawson Mercer's been fantastic too.
And, I mean, they didn't have to give him up to get Timo Meier. It is 5-4 now, Jersey over Colorado.
Wow. So Colorado scored. Grumpy, how do you know the score of the game?
Mental telepathy, my friend.
Okay, can you please stop pulling on that cord for the love of all that's old? Anytime you wear a sweatshirt, you pull on that cord. Anyway, a deep cut.
Russ Johnson can't skate, shoot, pass, or fight. Besides that, he's a terrific hockey player. Sounds like Josh Bailey.
Patrick Hamos, Grumpy.
It's the same old New York Strangers trying to buy the cup with free agency. That's why they'll lose again. That's not why they'll lose again. I just don't think they're that good. I don't think they're good enough.
Yep.
That's why.
I still want Meyer, and I commented many times. I want a Janot.
Janot.
I want a Janot. But what Tampa gave up is nuts. Grumpy, lock yourself in a room with TJ and Ace. I don't know.
Reyes. I don't know who that is. But I agree. I agree with everything he said.
Frank K said Kane will resign with the Rangers.
I agree he will.
John Smith said Kane backed Chicago into a corner. He only wanted to go to the Rangers, and everyone knew it. That's why they got away with paying so little.
That's why Panarin signed there. That's why Fox signed there. The Rangers have cachet. People saying, the Islanders,
The Rangers can get buy-in from people outside the organization who think legitimately they're good enough to win.
Well, but they're a big original six team, and they have marquee value. The Islanders don't. And it drives me crazy when people, the Islanders are a small market team. They're not. They play in freaking New York. They're not a small market team. And that small market mentality, that pushes me over the edge.
Oh, well, Columbus is a much bigger market than that, Grumpy. Nashville, much bigger market than in New York. Same thing with the Dallas Stars, Grumpy. All over the place. All these teams, Grumpy, much bigger. The Washington Capitals, they're much bigger market than the New York Islanders. Much bigger market than any team in New York.
It infuriates me when I hear that mentality. We're small.
Devils have bigger market than the New York Islanders too. It's just like, fuck that loser. It's like the loser mentality. True. Loser mentality. Doesn't mean that Dobson is bad. He just needs to be paired with Pelech. Yes.
100% agree.
Absolutely. Do the Josh Bailey. Suck around. Spread the suck around, baby.
Spread the suck
around. Ross hasn't won a fight since TJ had a full head of hair.
It's been a while since he's won a fight.
When's the last? He doesn't fight as much.
Well, I know, but it's been a while since he's won a fight. He used to win every fight. I forget who the guy who beat him first. Usually when those heavyweights lose, it's usually not good going forward. It's like those MMA fighters, UFC fighters. They're like invincible till they get beat once, and then they suck. It's tough.
Johnny Max says, good evening, gents. Ian says, hi. What's up, Ian? Everybody loading up with picks but us. Oh, boy.
Yeah. After the dust settles, I'm really interested to see who has the picks in the first round of this draft.
Bailey's on a point streak. He's on a scoring streak. One game. That was his first goal since December 27th.
7 goals this year. For a guy who plays power play, he's always out there. Missed some time with injury, but certainly not enough where he shouldn't have at least 8 goals.
Freedom Fund Adventure, Grumpy.
Reassert your dominance. That way Warden can't save him. You are too much of a softy and tender-hearted dad to put up with the way he treats you. That's right, TJ, talking about you.
Oh, my God, stop. You're ridiculous. By the way, you had asked this question, Grumpy. They popped it up here in notification. On average, the MLB spring training games are 22 minutes shorter by average with this new rule they've been rolling out.
It's great. Keep it up, MLB. that you'll get some fans back.
You think so?
Absolutely. Start the games early. Start them a half hour early, too. This way kids can go. Start every game no later than 7 o'clock. This way you're home. Let's say a game ends at 9:30. You're home by 10:30.
Joseph Seagrump.
It's just a matter of the Eastern Conference being super stacked. No one knows who's coming in the house, out of the East, even with Boston being world beaters. Like I said, I'm not even going to include the Rangers, but let's say we include the Rangers. The top six teams are really, really good. The bottom two are just trash. As a matter of fact, the bottom two teams wouldn't even make the playoffs in the West.
Rick Roma says, business is business, and Jonathan Quick stinks, but blindsiding a legend that won you multiple cups is not the classiest move for
that. That's
Rick, exactly what I want to say. Rick Roma, you understand better than anybody. There is no class. There is no freaking loyalty out there, Rick Roma, in the business world. You understand that better than anybody else, Rick. Yeah. Anyway, Alex Piazza Grumpy says, Lennox getting signed doesn't mean that Varlamov is getting traded. It's for next year. Yeah, he's just going to be in the AHL too. Patrick Camo says, yeah, the Gossip Share trade was good because he was in the last year of the contract. Yep. Nick C. Grumpy.
If the Rangers don't make the cup finals this year, they'll be in trouble. They have no cap space with two big pieces leaving this year, Kane and Tarasenko.
I think and Kane sits back.
And their better players are getting older, minus Panarin. I disagree. I mean,
Kako and Lafreniere are guys that they want to step up when these older players start to diminish. They have guys who are 22 years old that are putting up 40 points a season. What 22-year-old do we have that puts up 20 that puts up 40 points a year? What do we think about our team?
I think they'll try, if, you know, depending on, Kane's lingering injury, I could see them trying to sign him back. Tarasenko, I don't think they'll sign him back.
I know I'm going to get branded as a freaking Rangers fan, but I'm like, the Rangers, I don't think are in bad shape. I really don't. Goon Goon says, today the rock and roll group Kiss announced on their supposed last ever show, December 1st and 2nd at MSG. Grumpy, who was more popular on Long Island during the 1970s? The Islanders or Kiss?
You know, you can't compare sports and music, but Kiss was hugely popular on Long Island in the 70s. And the Islanders were towards the tail end. But gosh, I don't know. That's a tough one. That's a tough one. But music and hockey, you know, you can't really compare the two.
Tommy B says Tarasenko will be gone and Kane is only back if one of the restricted free agents leaves.
I disagree. I think
they'll find a way.
Yeah, I think they'll bring Kane back, but I think Tarasenko will be gone.
Yeah. Yes. Attention, Gus Despair, traded to the Hurricanes, says Storm Chase Mike. John McManaman says the Wings get our first round pick, and now, so no way we're falling to the bottom 12, even if we're only
6 points away from the 12th spot. Wow, I didn't realize that. I don't think we're going to be bottom 12.
Man, that's got to give Detroit a little extra fuel in their tank to make sure that, hey, they're beating a team in regulation. Deidre C said, I like Romanoff. Not as bad as some are making him out to be. Sure, he needs to clean up some things, but I like his physicality. And Mayfield would be a good piece to go.
Absolutely. Mayfield should be traded.
But that's why fans like him. He throws the body. He hits hard.
That's it. He throws the body. So he's a fan favorite.
Dude, I'm going to the game on Saturday. I like it. I like it, Frank. I'm excited for you. I want to sing like a world. I want to sing Sound of Music, he says here. Scott L. says, yep, Pittsburgh. There was that Pittsburgh trade here. Thank you.
No, they traded Teddy Bluger to Las Vegas for a third. And then they, like I said, the 2023 second for Granlin. Okay. Two different deals. Two separate deals.
Okay. Drew L. says here, I think TJ liked my response of using the same GIF he used for a different reason. Oh yeah, I picked a little funny. I'll show you the little funny little thing I posted there, Grumpy. Nick C. Grump.
Kane's got a really solid D-man and gotcha spare for only a third. I don't think he's really solid. He's a puck mover. You'd be help him on the power play. That's going to be a hard defense checking team to beat. He's not great defensively. But I still think it's a good deal for Carolina.
I'm got a comment here. If Carolina beats the living snot out of those, I hope Carolina beats the living snot out of those damn Rangers. And the Canes can't score.
That Pacioretty injury was a huge loss for them.
Good deal by Edmonton on Ekholm.
But think about what Chychrun got. Edmonton couldn't have made that deal for Chychrun. Doesn't that make them? I mean, I think
they don't need a guy who's more offensively. They need a guy who's a stay at home, steady Eddie defenseman.
Okay.
Joseph C. Grumpy.
They're built to win in the regular season, but not in the postseason. Talking about Edmonton.
So many trades. It's trade madness. How's Edmonton's goaltending?
It blows. It sucks and blows.
Well, Drew Ellison, this was grumpy. Hold on a second. Jesus Christ, that's going to be loud. It says, TJ, I don't mind the Engvall move. Also, TJ.
I am having a very bad day. I am in no mood. This today is one of the worst days that I've been in a long time.
That bass was extremely loud, but
it wasn't that loud.
Oh, you didn't think it was loud?
No, it was not loud.
Did I play that too softly for you, Grumpy?
I thought it was not loud.
You couldn't hear it?
I heard it, but I didn't think it needed to be a little louder.
You want me to replay it for you, Grumpy?
I don't care.
Okay. You keep reading. Shay.
Shay, our friend Shay. Just want you all to keep in mind the Islanders don't have a third round pick this year. So yes, if we finish outside the bottom 12, we don't have a first or a third.
That's correct.
So we won't have a first and a third this year.
Toronto has made five trades reshaping their team to be playoff ready. I think they finally get past Tampa.
Toronto was my dark horse to win the Stanley Cup, and I think that they can beat Tampa. I don't think they can beat Boston. I didn't expect Boston to be this good. I don't think anybody did. I thought Boston might not even make the playoffs this year. But I did pick them for number four in that division. But
Joseph Keane said the Canes desperately need a team of Meyer. Yep. They should have traded for him instead of the Devils. Lou, Apex Legends Senior Citizen says, Lou's selling picks. The Islanders won't even make the playoffs. Lou is a joke. Meanwhile, Ishikov rots in the A. Dufour tearing it up to Lou sucks.
Lou sucks.
Matthew S. said, Yarsman's doing a great job with this team. I love Steve UI. He's a great general manager. I wish Steve UI was our general manager. Shay Grumpy.
But I don't mind the trade we did. Good skating forward who's young for next year's third in a very weak draft.
What a film saying last night's game was as boring and dull as Aaron Rodgers. Oh, man.
Sleeping in the dark room.
Pony Curtis says, fire Shannon, hire Shay.
Oh!
Arizona has 10 second-round picks in the next 3 years.
Yeah, they have 27 picks in the first five rounds in the next 3 years. Think about that.
Must
and
be
here's nice. The thing, you know what they're going to do?
Straight up into the first round.
That's right. They're going to package stuff. I mean, okay. Will they do anything? They're still run by the NHL, so you know they don't want to pay anyone anything.
Yes.
But, you know, they're not going to pick 10 second rounders in the next 3 years.
Yep. Hart is a good goalie for Philly, says Frank. Yeah. And I guess Mayfield and Varlamov are going nowhere, Goon.
Probably going nowhere.
Probably going nowhere. Yeah, probably not.
That's the only thing that upset, and that was the only thing that upset me with the Horvat trade was that tells me direction of the team.
Yep. Arizona's a joke, said Matthew S. I thought Romanoff's game has picked up as of late. Even positionally and blocking his shots, him and Pulak were good together. Why aren't they putting Dobson with Pelech? Because Aho is just really bad.
Yeah. I don't understand it either. Maybe they're trying to make Mayfield look better before the trade deadline so they can move him.
If I'm a fan of Ottawa, Buffalo, and Detroit, I'm feeling pretty good long term. So am I. Absolutely. I'm getting hopeful where it's like next year, I'm getting all excited about what's going to happen going into the season.
I mean, I think we talked about this last show about, you know, Boston limited shelf life, regardless of how well they're playing this year. This could be the last kick of the can for Bergeron, Krejci, Marchand's getting up there. But then you look at, you know, Washington's on the way down, Pittsburgh's on the way down. Then you look at the teams that are on the way up, Buffalo for certain, Detroit, Ottawa, and the Islanders are on the way down. It's like you got a whole bunch of newer teams who are young and good. That's a problem for us going forward.
And they're all, I guess, where they all live, the Eastern Conference. Yeah. Gugun says, all of these foolers saying, yeah, but blank have four games. Yeah, but they have four games in hand. No way do any of these mediocre teams win all four of those games.
I agree. I think, for me, I'd much rather have the points in the bank. Like I said, if somebody gets hot, it's about just a team getting hot. Whoever are the two teams that get hot down the stretch, those are going to be your two finalists, your two final teams in the wild card spots. Just that plain and simple.
Putnam Curtis says, Islander fans, say hello to our next New York Islanders general manager, future first ballot Hall of Famer, and jersey number 12 retiree, Josh Bailey, and his new assistant general manager, Fredo Lamorino. God love that. God love that. Putnam Curtis said, yeah, Gungun, they have already a better point percentage. That's my thing. They are on pace. If you ended the season now, they with the point percentage, they have more points per games played than we do.
If the Islanders win the next four games, they're making the playoffs, period.
Okay, if they win the next four games. So that's a big if.
These are all four-point games. If we lose all four, we're done.
Even if we split, we're done. If you don't come out with a 3-win-1-loss record, you're done.
Okay. They still have to catch us. Like, Buffalo's got Boston tomorrow night.
Oh, is Georgia's star defensive lineman, Jalen Carter, in deep doo-doo?
Do you remember the car accident month and a half or so ago, whatever it is, Georgia, their young offensive tackle prospect and one of their scouts were killed in a car crash.
Yep.
Jalen Carter was drag racing with them. And they've issued a warrant for his arrest. What's that going to do for his draft stock?
Hey, isn't it funny? They said, keep playing, Jalen. Didn't he play? He played. Well, how long ago was that? Remind me, please, Grumpy.
No, the death was after the season. The deaths were after the season.
Okay. I added StreamYard to the list.
Okay.
Can you hear me? Yeah, it's a stupid shit where Siri starts trying to think I'm speaking to it. Okay. But Jalen Carter, I mean, how long ago did that happen, that death and that accident?
Middle of January, late January. The season was over. But it's like it took you this long to find that out. That's a long time, month and a half.
Yeah. I'm bringing the 15-year-old hockey player, Nella
Lupsanova.
She's got 19 points, 10 goals, 9 assists. She has 28 games played, 49 points, or I'm sorry, 28 goals, 21 assists, and 49 points in 8 games. Also plays with the boys under 18 team. She's got 18 goals, 25.
U16 team.
I'm sorry, U16 team. And she's got 18 goals, 25 assists, 43 points in 13 games.
I'm just going to say by the time those boys are 18 and she's 18, she won't be putting up those numbers.
Yeah.
Girls mature way earlier than guys.
Dan Percy says Pitt just made a move. Yes, they did. The Islanders are ninth in the conference in point percentage. Yeah. Yep. The Islanders are hot, says Frank. Matthew S. says, to me, it was a very meh trade. Yeah. Not terrible, but nothing exciting about it.
That's the way I look at it, man. I think that was my reaction when you first mentioned it. Think, meh.
Putnam Curtis said, trading away our future to get swept by Boston or Carolina. Shaking my head.
Exactly. Yeah, that's the issue I have. There's no way we're beating Carolina or Boston. No way.
Drew L says, I know on Twitter yesterday, TJ said he hopes teams like the Mets are going to be good during the inevitable rebuild. What TJ should have been watching is the turned around team, the Mecca, the New York Knicks. Imagine if Salo had all the playing time Aho had. He'd have like 10 goals and a bunch of assists. That's right.
True. I don't like how he was just an afterthought, really.
Pavel Datsyuk, sixth rounder. Yeah, but they don't work out. Come on, Dan. Sixth round picks, they never pan out. Anders Lee, no. He's just an average guy. Players like that don't ever make the roster. Yeah, Sorokin. It's also one of those third round picks that don't pan out. Thank you. And we pulled it up later, but thank you, the Wicked 50 Cal. I forgot about him. Yeah. How about Pavel? I wonder where was Pavel? Oh, yeah. Pavel Datsyuk.
Russia.
Gotcha. And if only, but Lou doesn't like Robin Salo.
That's what it is.
Hates his draft picks. Yep.
Well, thank God. Maybe he's trying to trade everyone. Can't spread the hate around so much.
Can't spread the suck around. I have to Cal Sorka's a third rounder. Yep. Drew says, I agree with you, Grumpy. Agree with Grumpy's take on draft picks. Just in this instance, like I said earlier, I think Engvall has untapped potential. I still think that the Horvat trade was dumb, but I like this one.
Okay. I'm just like, meh, whatever. I don't think you're gonna see Engvall's game take off where he's a top six winger. I just don't.
Who the heck is this? Grumpy, Abu, what's your opinion?
I don't even know who that is.
I don't know who that is.
Abu Ghraib. I don't know who that is.
Enlighten us. Drew L says it'll only backfire if the draft pick Toronto gets is a quality top six forward or generational.
No. He was Toronto had to get rid of him. He wasn't going to play anymore. He was going to be a healthy scratch.
The Freedom Fund Adventure says, TJ, maybe Engvall is a signal that the Islanders are moving away from Bailey, Parise, etc. Would that have changed your opinion? Also, Fashion can't score, so he can walk. Islanders have enough players who can't score.
See, I like Fashion.
What's his first
Fashion and his brother Hunter? Both of them.
Maybe he does have a brother named Hunter Fashing. Wouldn't that be something?
The Hunter Boys.
The Hunter Boys. Huntala.
The Hunter.
Frank Grumpy.
No way, dude. Are you smoking crack? Horvat trade was a team changer for the best. He makes everyone look better, and he makes Barzal the 90-point player he's supposed to be. I don't know if he'll make him a 90-point player, but he absolutely makes us better going forward.
I'm telling you. Phil's fax is a maniac, Grumpy. He's a freaking maniac. He's saying that, because the Oilers beat the Maple Leafs today, you know, Kyle Dubas traded away the Maple Leafs' best defensive forward, best defensive winger. And without Engvall, the team, you know, without his speed and tenacious forechecking, they look slow and lethargic out there on the ice.
Okay, Phil. I think the game's played in Edmonton, right, today?
He's funny. I'll tell you that. Tim J. Grumpy said, I think Lou does think that they will win a cup, sadly.
I don't think he cannot possibly think that. He's not stupid. Maybe a little bit of his cheese has slipped off the cracker, but he's not totally gone. He has to know. He just knows that the rebuild is going to be he could have been proactive the last couple of years. Moved little pieces off, brought in younger guys, but he chose not to. He believed in this group, and that belief was unfounded. Sorry.
Oh, man, Grumpy. I'll tell you. Got here another comment there from Joseph C. Grump.
Kyle Dubas just throwing as much shit at the wall, hoping the Maple Leafs get past the first round. They're going to have to beat Tampa. Again, that's, you know, I don't feel bad for Toronto. But all these years, they've either had to play Boston, who was too tough for them physically, or Tampa was just too damn good in the first round every year. That's why they don't win. They're playing it probably, it's a top-heavy division, but the toughest division in the league for the last number of years. Tampa? Boston? Tampa. Boston? Toronto? Florida last year?
Punnyberg Curtis Grumpy.
The boys on the team should start buying real estate on your guys' domes since the shape of y'all's hairlines are that of a cul-de-sac. No? I would say no, Drew. Ponyboy, no.
Fair enough, Ponyboy Curtis. Tommy B says Lou has no interest in developing younger players anymore because he has 1 foot in the grave.
And the other on a banana peel.
Grumpy. Can the Islanders trade Nassau Coliseum for a draft pick?
Why not?
Give up anything and everything.
Maybe they trade it for a veteran player.
Good gracious. Frank said, you guys didn't answer me. The Islanders signed the rookie. Oh, we got that. We've signed that already. Lou, does that mean that Lou got a clue and will trade Varlamov for a King's ransom? No, they're not going to roll with Lennox or a guy like.
Why not bring up Corey Snyder?
Yeah, man.
It doesn't matter. You're talking about three or four games from the backup. Freaking backup. The backup.
Tom White says Datsuk was pick 171. Zetterberg pick 210.
I think Zetterberg was like an eighth round pick.
Tony Bino says here his job is to win a Stanley Cup and not build for 10 years from now.
Well, he's not winning a Stanley Cup. He's not going to, he'll never win another Stanley Cup. Lou Lamoriello will never win another Stanley Cup because he's with the Islanders. He's never winning a Stanley Cup.
Hold on. And you think building for 10 years from now, players that are drafted now, I mean, like, you're going to see results out of them before they're 28 years old. And here's the other thing, too. We're not winning a cup is right. And your job as a general manager is to keep not only the short-term success in mind, but also the team's long-term success. You're a steward of the franchise and a steward of the organization. And he is completely neglecting one of his responsibilities as steward of our team. Read the ads in the comments, you bald-headed jerks. We added speed to this team, which this team desperately needs, says Shay. Oh, man. Joseph C. says, Sands Casino just bought Nassau Coliseum, actually. I didn't know that. Paulo C. said, Cup. Are you guys talking about the Cup? Guys, please, we'll be lucky if we even make the playoffs. And if we do make it, we have absolutely no chance in hell to beat Boston or Carolina.
True.
Oh,
true. Those are just facts. We might make the playoffs. Matter of fact, I like our chances of making the playoffs. I just think that we're, with the veterans that we have, we're just a little bit more battle-tested than the younger teams.
Chris Stearman says, 8:47. I thought you guys would just be starting. Consistency is key, fellas. Hold on. Chris, you must have missed it when I made the New Year's resolution that I was going to be on time every single podcast this year. And we've been so damn close. Almost every single week, maybe within about 5 minutes of being on time every single show. Most time we're on time, too. Coach Tommy B says, get ready, the Islander fans, for Salo for Kulikov coming soon. Gosh.
That would be a horrible trade. That would be a horrible trade. Kulikov sucks. He's finished. He's absolutely toast. Done and dusted. Salo, did he even get a legit shot? Another guy who played, what, not even 10 games after just coming over. You know, he played his first season in the North American game last year.
North American ice surface last year. Yeah.
I don't get.
A lot of things I don't get, Grumpy. But yeah. JP, Grump.
This franchise is in trouble for a long time. You're in trouble, man.
Oh, God. Islander fans need to rise up and have an undeterred chant. Fire, Lou. Well, now fans are happy to say, oh, we win games. Yay, we're winning games right now.
Win a couple games.
Tommy B says, I like Grinlin too, but he can't play goalie.
Goalie. They don't have a goalie. Pittsburgh's never beating us without that goalie. They dominated us every single game they played against us. They dominated us, but they don't have a goalie. We just throw the puck on the net, goal.
Chris Dierman says Engvall is better than, you know, what you get in a third rounder, and you don't have to develop him. We've already proven that wrong. But
sorry, Chris.
Oh no, we have. I mean, we have later on the show we did. Dan L said that's why. I like to get picks. You never know what you might get.
Hey, that's when the Islanders were really bad for, many, 30 years, the best time was draft time. Because, hey, yeah, look at this guy. They're all going to make it. But at least it gives you some excitement. Oh my God. Something to look forward to.
Mario says here, Lamoriello and Putin share the same philosophy. Putin thinks he can beat Ukraine by sending wave after wave of Russian soldiers who are nothing more than cannon fodder. Lou thinks we can win a Stanley Cup by sending death player after death player against teams like Boston and the Canes into the playoffs.
There you go.
Grumpy Auburn up by 20 with 9 minutes left, says Johnny Mack.
That's a win. John, are they going to qualify for the NCAAs?
Freaking Pittsburgh lost to Notre Dame tonight. I got a notification. Like, fuck. The best team in the ACC lost to the second worst team in the ACC. I'm like, son of a bitch. JP says, problem is, by the time the team has a real shot to win a cup, Engvall's what, 31, 32, 33 years old? Same with a lot of these guys, because we keep all the old players on the cul-de-sac crew without restocking.
True.
This is our point. Thank you, JP. That's exactly the point of the show.
Thank you.
We can still subtract the ballerina and no-hit Noah.
No-hit Noah.
I honestly, no-hit Noah is a funny one. Oh my God.
Who hits in the NHL anymore, D Cut? Does anyone hit in the NHL that's anymore?
True.
One does. No.
Chris Yearman says Horvat is going to get more points than Barzal. Discuss. He makes less.
I don't know if that's the case.
Horvat, what, has like 8 points in 12 games? I'm not like saying, oh, that's not great, but he's been a guy whose career has been like 55, 60 point guy year in, year out. He's having a career season and a contract year. And since he's joined the Islanders, well, we've seen production kind of like that 55 to 60 point range once he signed that long-term contract. I like what I've seen out of him. I think he does a little bit of everything. I just feel like he's a guy who is in his prime, and I feel like this team's window is not open.
I just don't like the fact that he signed as an unrestricted free agent when he could have had so many teams bidding on him, and he as the number one target in the offseason, and he signed a deal before that. I won't understand that. I'll never understand it.
Nick C says here, how are you okay with the Penguins trading a second for a 31-year-old, but not okay with us trading a third for a 26-year-old? They have around the same points. I usually agree with you both, but you're wrong on this. I'm glad you brought that up. Pittsburgh is in a win-now mode. I think they should also be looking to retool. But Pittsburgh, you look at the team, Crosby doesn't look the same. Malkin is having a great year, but Malkin doesn't have a long time left. Letang has limited time left. All of these players that are legitimate first ballot Hall of Famers are all towards the tail end with them.
That's
we have no Hall of Famers on our team. None.
Right. And you look at our best players, Barzal, Horvat, Nelson. Nelson's 30, but the other two guys are under 30. They have some time left. I can see. Here's the thing. I understand why Pittsburgh's doing it. I didn't say it was the right thing, but I understand why they're doing it, because they once those guys are gone, they're in full rebuild.
You can't give up on Crosby, Malkin, and Letang
and say we're tanking.
Yeah, that's three first ballot Hall of Fame caliber players on that team. They've won cups before. I know they haven't won a first round in what, maybe 4 years, five, however long it's been, right? But that's a team where it's like, are you just going to say, hey, first ballot Hall of Famer? I mean, Sidney Crosby's a generational talent. Evgeny Malkin's a generational talent. We don't have players that come close to sniffing those players now. We don't have players in their prime that sniff Crosby at 34, 35. Not even close.
True.
I understand why they're doing it. I don't understand why we're doing it. They have top-end talent. We do not. We have a goalie. They don't have a goalie. So, you know, goalie should be what they're looking for next.
They're not winning a Stanley Cup either.
Correct.
I don't care what they do.
I don't think they're winning a Stanley Cup either.
No.
They have a better chance of winning a cup than we do.
That's true.
That's my point.
If they had a goalie.
We'd be saying they're a real contender.
They just don't have a goalie.
They outplay us on a consistent basis, but lose because their goalie lets in weak-ass goals. You're one player away from being a team that's a better competitor. We are not one player away from being a Stanley Cup competitor.
True.
Goon Goon Grump.
Dream, 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 dream. Goon Goon says, I read somewhere that Barzal is week to week, expected back before the end of the year, or maybe I dreamt it. So I sang him the song.
Oh. I was like, what the fuck's going on? Matthew, I said, D-Cut hitting the vodka early, I guess. Oh, man, there it is. Rumors are Parise's hanging up his skates after the season. Trade his ass.
Yeah, trade him. Do you want a shot at the cup? Do you want a legit shot at the cup, Zach? We'll try. We're going to move you to a contender.
Stop these fucking handshake deals. Stop them. Lou R says here, can we stop or limit this dump and chase game? They work hard to get possession in our zone. They hit the opposing blue line and chip it into the corner. We lose it 90% of the time. It's a puck possession game.
We are not our talent level. Our talent base are not puck possession guys, except for a couple.
Yep.
Except for number 13, not puck possession guys. They're dinosaurs saying everyone, it used to be the chip and chase game. That's what it used to be back when Lou was, you know, GM of the Devils in the 90s.
Drew L says here, Lou, if he was really productive, could have gotten Rasmus Sandin last offseason for nothing, and Toronto were willing just to get rid of him. Yeah.
I don't think they were willing to get rid of him in last off season. because but they the advancement of a couple other young defensemen is why he's out now. But why is he not in that a trade chance for that?
Because we already fucking traded away the 13th overall pick for Alexander Romanov.
Who would you rather have, Romanov or Sandin?
I know what we have in Romanov. I don't really know what they've got in Sandin, but I can tell you one thing. I'm not very excited with what I have with Romanov. That's for certain.
There you go.
Jeff F says here, Jeff Feynman says, Engvall's nickname in Toronto is Seabiscuit. The ladies on Long Island are going to love his big horse penalty killing abilities. TJ, I bet we are trading Varlamov. Why would the Islanders sign the rookie goalie to the AHL? That means, you know, they're going to bring up Corey Snyder. We need picks. So trade Varlamov, sign in the summer.
I don't think he's going to do it, but if that's part of the deal, I'm all for it.
We sign guys midway through the year all the time. And I think this is just Tristan Lennox getting that sign. Frank, I wish that would be the case, but I don't think that it is. And we're just going to be sad on this Saturday. Holy shit, it's Wednesday already. Woo. JP said, I changed my mind about Engvall. If Lou Lamoriello turned around and sold, yep, Martin, Parise, Bailey, Clutterbuck, Mayfield, Nelson, Johnston, Lee, Cizikas. I'm not sure that many would be sold, but if he sold a few pieces, I'd be excited about what he did.
If you wanted him as the Parise replacement, just could have signed him in the offseason. If you move Parise, okay. Then you could say, okay, we're still trying to get better. We got the replacement going forward. We're okay. Engvall's not going to turn the season around for us. Let me just put it that way.
Chris Stearman, we got a lot of comments, Grumpy. We're going to go rapid fire, Grumpy. Chris Stearman.
Grumpy, is there a lighthouse in that picture of the waves behind you? No.
Oh, gosh. Tony Cheese saying, all shit on white boys. What's up, Tony Cheese? Man, when people say trade Nelson, it just makes me a little angry. It just makes me laugh. He says, Daryl Lynch says here, Lou cleared out our first and second round picks. Now he's working on the third round pick. No cup for a while.
That's right, Daryl.
Patrick Camo says here, we win in the cup, boys. Any chance is a good chance. God
almighty. Got to make the playoffs first.
JP says, Brock Nelson's 31 years old and at his highest value. Yes.
True.
I would have no problem if they traded Nelson today, but they're not going to.
No.
Joseph C said, McDavid with another 2 goals tonight, 5 straight games with 2 goals a game.
He's on a heater.
Dude's a video game. Come on, TJ and Grumpy. The Islanders will grab the 8th seed and go 16-0 in the playoffs. Everybody knows that. That's correct.
Why not optimism? You got to love it.
I've been convinced. Islanders are winning the cup. Patrick Hamo says here, Engvall might be a good pickup, but if he fits in the system and all that, it's up in the air.
I think he'll fit the system. I don't think there's a problem with that. But he's not a difference maker. He's just, like I said, if you think that he's going to turn us around, I think you're mistaken.
Let's see here. Frank says here, he's a star-studded player center with like 3 to 5 good years left. We could get 1,000 picks and never be as good, as good as a player like Nelson, who's finding his scoring touch now that he's free of trots.
By the time we're good, Nelson won't be. That's why you move Nelson at his highest value. It's not going to happen, but it's something we should do. That's okay. All I'm saying.
1,000 picks would be 4.5 years of an NHL draft.
We get everybody.
Four and a half years every single pick.
I like our chances.
I do like the 1,000 picks, but Brock Nelson's been great, but we got to notice that he's at the peak right now, and you would get the most you can for him.
Like I said, trade Josh Bailey after that first playoff run they had. I'm like, he'd never played better. He looked good in the playoffs. I'm like, this is when you need to move Josh Bailey. They didn't. And now you get, because you could probably gotten a first round pick for Josh Bailey. Instead, you got nothing but heartache.
Gungun said, we are going to get his name retired in the rafters in 1,000 career games with the Islanders. So he is a club legend. Islander legend, Grump. Even with all the big names traded, I just don't see the Rangers beating the Bruins or the Hurricanes. Did I hit the nail on the head, or should I go to bed?
You hit the nail on the head.
Trade for somebody like Engvall, and they know you like them. Nobody signs either Islanders as a free agent. So now the bigotry of low expectations is the Islanders cannot even entice a bottom six forward who who was a healthy scratch in Toronto, to sign as a free agent. We can't sign. What is it going to be next? We can't sign AHL guys because nobody wants to play in Bridgeport. We can't sign ECHL guys because nobody wants to play in Worcester.
Would you want to play for Fredo?
No. So okay. Maybe I would. Hey, Chris is on to something here now, Grumpy. The Jets don't have much vet experience. Dan P said, Clash
of the Titans in the Eastern Conference.
Nelson's not a stud. I'm sorry. Comes up small. Big games. They lost 1-0 in Game 7 against Tampa. And the Eastern Conference Finals. Tony P said, you never know. God, I hate that shit. You never know.
Okay. Is Pittsburgh winning the cup? Is
no.
Detroit winning a cup or no. Buffalo or Ottawa no. or Washington? Because no. we're in the same bowl of suck as all those teams. So yeah. If you say yes to those teams, win the cup, okay. But if you say no to them, you can't say yes to us because they're all the same.
Shay said here, I have a question. The Canucks traded this year's first round pick from the Islanders. What happens if that pick of the Islanders falls into a bottom 12 spot? We are 6 points ahead of the bottom 12 spot.
I don't think we're coming in the bottom 12.
I don't think we have to worry about it. But to answer your question, I think they would get the pick next year.
Honestly, I wish we would. If we came in the bottom 12 and kept that pick, I'd feel good about it. I would, because it's like, okay, we're still picking in the top 12. Maybe we get lucky with the ping pong balls. But I don't see it happening. Sorry.
Chris said you have to keep Varlamov for the push. End of discussion. Chris, how many games is Varlamov going to play in the playoffs? One? Maybe. If you're going to a Stanley Cup, maybe he plays one game if your goalie has a bad night. One game? Varlamov.
None. He's not playing at all.
He's a backup, Grumpy. What is
Varlamov? Backup. Here's the thing. He might play four games the rest of the season. He might as well just pack his bags and go home. Because he's not playing again.
They've won nothing, says JP.
True.
How about that low-class piece of shit Miller? Yes, Keandre Miller spitting on Drew Doughty in the media. The media gave him a pass?
I guess so.
What the? That was a blatant spit. We broke it down on TJ.
He got a three-game suspension.
He did it so smooth, too. He didn't, like, if you spit, you should go, and you put your face forward.
Looks like he's been spitting on people his whole life.
And he's been getting away with it, too. Paul Feinstein says here, the only team I can think that would want Varlamov now could be the Edmonton Oilers. Maybe. Any other team you guys can think of? Well, I think all the Canadian teams are on his do-not-trade list. He's got that modified 16-team no-trade clause because of Lou Lamoriello. We can't trade him any Canadian teams, I think.
They need to cut that old man off from the cash. Because let's say he brings Varley back. You think you're still going to give a backup, no move clause or no trade clause? He's freaking backup.
Backup.
Freaking backup.
CJ Scoot says maybe Vegas.
What about Seattle?
I don't know. I don't think we're trading.
Just get him out of here.
We're talking about a hypothetical that's not going to happen. We're not trading anything away. And if he traded Varlamov, I will say fantastic. I'm happy. I'm glad he took a step in the right direction today.
Has Ovechkin come back yet?
Yeah, he's been back.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Varlamov plays 4 or 5 games with the goalie move. Some team just made Varlamov gets a first round, a first, second, and another pick or player. I love Varlamov, but we can't squeak by with Corey Schneider.
Ugh. Squeak by where? He's a freaking backup. He's a backup. He's a freaking backup.
What is he going?
He's not a player on the team.
What is he going?
He's easily replaceable. He doesn't deserve to play. We have so many days off in between since we played so many games this year.
Yes.
We
have so many games in hand. We've got the more rest than any other team. We've got more games played than any team in the NHL. We've got more rest than any team left the remainder.
18 games to play in a month and 2 months.
4 games. You're averaging 9 games a month. Four games you need a backup for. Tops.
Don't even need a backup.
Get rid of them. What goes to Detroit? I think it's a team's choice, but that's my main question. Okay. I don't know. I agree. So sad. I won't say more. No need to drag politics into this, says Dan L. I don't know. You weren't. Oh. I'm not sure. Maybe it was the with Lamoriello throwing depth players in, thinking they're going to win a cup against the Bruins. Nick C said, I read something that the reason why Varlamov will not be traded is he helped sign Sorokin long-term. He definitely did help get Sorokin over here. Absolutely, he did.
Is to help Sorokin sign long-term.
Oh, I'm sorry. I misread that. Okay. It's why, it's because he's not going to be traded. It's to help Sorokin sign long-term. He wants to stay on a $1.5 million by $2 contract for 2 years.
Have a gentleman's agreement with him that says, we're going to move you now. We're going to sign you back 2 years, $1.5 million in the offseason.
Yeah, let's get a handshake deal going so we could just sign him in free agency.
And then give the rest of that money that you allocate to the goaltender position to Sorokin. That solves your problem. But no more than 2 years for a backup.
A backup?
Freaking backup.
Tom White, Grumpy.
You forgot that Sorokin will have 9 shutouts. And Bailey will lead the playoff scoring race with 6 hat tricks.
Oh,
my. Sarcasm off.
Ah, there it is. Sarcasm off, Grumpy. Coach Tommy B.
Lou only likes young people if they're changing his diaper and wiping his backside. Mm. And Tommy Baffy would know.
David D says here, hello, gentlemen. What defenseman would you like still on the market for a trade?
I'm not making any trades for anybody.
I was about to say, I'm not adding anything else.
And we don't have a whole lot to offer.
We've got a third round pick this year to offer and a fourth round pick. And we also have picks next year. We're going to still give up more capital for more freaking underwhelming players. Players you never heard of. You're like, who the hell is this? What? Who? Oh, yeah. I've seen, I guess, them on ice a few times, but I really haven't paid much attention to them.
The whole thing is if Lamoriello trades the 2024 first, what's he going to do in next year's trade deadline?
Not be here.
Oh, okay.
This is the last year. He's 80 years old. I'm going to let you read the comments, Grumpy. We're at 3 hours, so I want to get through a few comments here quickly, but I'm going to just let you take control of this. So
why don't you go through and pick selected?
We're not going to be able to do that, so just start reading, please.
What do we think for a Sorokin contract? 8 years, $8 million. I'd go 8 years, $7.5 million.
I'm down 8 years by eight.
Okay. 6.5 over 8 years, that's not getting it done.
No.
Nick C says, the only realistic person I can see this team trading is Mayfield. That is the only person I can realistically see Lou trading because there's no way we can keep him. Even if you can't keep him, who cares? You trade him and you sign him back in the offseason. What's the matter?
Grump,
did TJ ever send you the free pair of the Raycon earbuds? No, he kept the first pair and the half-off pair for himself.
Oh, stop. Coach Tommy B said, Coach Mavie's Corner tomorrow night, 7:30 to 8:30 Eastern Standard Time. Rick Rock, Grump.
If Varley plays any games in any possible playoff series, we are already in trouble. He's a top ticket to move now. Great show. Thank you, Rick.
CJ Scoots.
Next 4 games should be very interesting. Islanders kind of control their destiny, playing Detroit, Buffalo, Pittsburgh, and Washington. That's correct.
Dan L.
The baby says, I just look at Bobrovsky getting $10 million per season. Got to think he needs to be paid in that area. I was thinking $8 million might be too low. Well, you never know. Maybe they could trick him into, signing for a low ball deal.
You don't understand this contract. Sign right here. Frank.
Yeah, just like they did in the KHL. This is where you sign. Please trade Mayfield. I went from loving him to almost hating him. Not an offensive guy, Scott. Freaking stop shooting. It's embarrassing. That's what drives me crazy when he thinks he's a forward. He's not. And he can score some nice goals too, but he's not a forward. Drew says, by the way, TJ, when you said he's part of the problem in the DMs, did you mean Lou or Phil? Both.
Both. Yeah. you go there. Paulo C.
In the East, only teams I see winning the cup is Boston, Carolina, the Rangers. I don't see Jersey, Toronto, or Tampa. New Jersey because of experience in goaltending, Toronto because of goaltending, Tampa lack of speed. Okay, that's fair. Max Power says, good evening, gents. Is it mathematically possible to be this awful in shootouts? It is. Realistically, it's possible also. This is why we should and need bring up Rusalin Nishikov. That guy is an arsenal is too big. Why not?
We saw that shootout goal he had there.
It was phenomenal.
It was great.
Tony Cheese says Drew Muff dives into low tide smelling cooch in his mom's basement. Ouch. I think a little off topic. Jason Cameron says, you know, we stink when a dud like Holmstrom is on the first line. Absolutely. When he's on any line, you know, we suck. Tommy Baffy says TJ should be forced to read every one of Dave Cutler's comments on air twice.
That would be funny. Hold on, let's get here. Yes. Because yep, of me.
Because of me as a 30-year-old fan, I'm the jinx. Correct.
Oh, man. There you go. Frank Grumpy.
Time to send Holmstrom down. I pray Lou was playing him to trade him, not justify his pick, which is probably why. That's exactly why. Because he sucks. Shaker. He says Lou is done going for ex-Devils now that he's going for ex-Leafs players who played for him. Yeah, all the ex-Devils are gone. They have a young, good team now, so he wouldn't even recognize them.
You want to know what was funny? Somebody made a tweet really quickly right after Timo Meier had signed or was traded for the Devils. They said, congratulations, Islander fans. Or New York Islanders will be trading for Timo Meier 10 years from now. So, very Nick. Possible. Nick Mirlatis.
Now, Islanders upset win in the first round.
Nick M., I'm sorry. Oh, man. Paul F., Grumpy.
I'm 27, and I know this team is a clown show, and I want cups like y'all. I got an old soul in these bones, and I wish I could take control of the team and fix it. And the Islanders never say die podcast image. Absolutely, Paul.
There it is, Paul. Drew L., Grumpy.
I agree with TJ here. Despite all the losing with the Knicks, even if they miss the playoffs, they are 1 second away from burning Madison Square Garden down.
Shay Grumpy.
Just like your boy Noah Dobson, my God, has he been so bad this year.
Shay, so glad we gave him bridge contract. God.
Not a long-term deal.
Oh, my God. TJ, there already is a juggernaut in New York, and it's the New York Knicks. Sunday sand, Grumpy.
Grumpy kicks it old school. No participation trophies. Making the playoffs is not the same as winning the cup. That's right, Sunday Sand. Yes.
Frank Grumpy.
I'm 52, but maturity of a 32-year-old. Really? Okay. I was 10 through 13 when they won those cups. Imagine how hard it is for me to see these shit years. I agree with you, Frank. I was at perfect age for the, you know, I was like teenager through early 20s when they won the cups. I mean, it was nothing better than that. Don't join the dark side, TJ, and ignore that BCBS league, the NBA. Absolutely.
I got a comment here, Paulo Seagrump.
Eastern Conference, Boston will win the cup. I don't see any team beating them. And for Tampa, they'll be out fast in the first round this time. Toronto beat them. Tampa rely too much on their power play and goaltending. Well, you know what? That's what you need in the playoffs.
Flex Crew
says, Lou Lambs. About to get a 2-year extension as a reward for pushing this franchise back to mediocrity. Zero accountability in this franchise. 100% agree.
Nick M.
says the Islanders are built for the playoff grind, not the regular season. We got a franchise goalie in net. Bring it, baby.
Paul F. Grumpy.
Giants are building toward a good team with a good office leaders and a coach. No quarterback, though.
You can't win without a QB. D-cut.
As usual, the ball-headed jerk TJ is only reading YouTube comments.
I'm hearing it.
Oh, shit. That was from D-Cut.
Shay.
Another YouTube comment from Shay. I took a quiz and who my best NFL, my NHL best friend is, and I got Anders Lee.
So this is a funny one. Do you remember when this happened years, and thank you, Shay, for sending this to me. This happened years and years ago, and this is the real Darren Drager's Twitter account. This was on February 21st of 2020. Remember that podcast? I think that was a long time ago, but I remember a podcast that sources say the Islanders have traded Ilya Sorokin's rights to Chicago.
I remember that.
Mm-hmm. And we're like, what the fuck is going on here? The white whale. Thank you there, Shay, for that non-fun memory to relive, but it's funny to look back on. Scott L. Grumpy.
Jonathan Quick may not be in Columbus for long. Frank Cervelli, a hockey insider, said he may go to Vegas soon. But need some money. The money needs to get worked out. Why would we not move Varlamov to Vegas?
Because
he's a better goalie than Quick.
A much better goalie than Quick.
Absolutely. At this stage.
Drew L says here, Grumpy, you're wrong. Mahomes' wife and brother is more famous than Patrick Mahomes is. He'd be getting mobbed.
Why are they famous? Because Patrick Mahomes is their brother and wife. That's why.
Husband. Yeah. Coach Tommy B.
Sorry, Patrick. Tommy B says, I'm looking forward to the Rangers-Devils playoff series. It'll be big-time entertaining. 100% agree with that.
Drew asks Grump.
Someone want to do a welfare check on the Red Ranger Power Ranger, the Red Power Ranger, after we failed to acquire him in a trade? Absolutely.
We do need to check on him. Shay Grump. Wow.
Look at this. I Googled pictures of Lou being mad, and a gif of him picking his nose popped up.
Patrick Hamos says, we need a picture of Beaky Lou back.
Beaky Lou. Beaky the Buzzard.
Craig says, not. No freaking TJ. Not. No. Fucking not, TJ. We suck at picks overall, but most picks don't work out. We need players. Patrick Hamos says,
I hate to tell you, but Brett's picks are players.
Just Patrick Hamos says, bro, if we face Boston, or no, he didn't say bro, but bro,
if we face Boston in the playoffs, game one, we score the first goal and put them on their back foot at home and shut them up. It's all downhill cruising from there. How we looked against Boston this year?
Great. We're going to win. I think you're right, Patrick. We're going to be, it's going to be like you're driving a Mack truck down a freaking, down one of those steep declines where your emergency brakes don't work and your brakes are giving out. We're just barreling through everything. Declan says, why did Koivula get to stay in the lineup over Durando or Tryishikov in the line with Horvat? Why not?
Why not?
Freedom, fun, adventure.
The Islanders overcome all odds and laws of physics and win the cup. Jesus. This year, will they invite all of us fans to their block party at the cul-de-sac? Any D-men you'd like guys like to get? No, I don't. I'm not looking to add anyone.
Do you think we're
not winning the Stanley Cup? We're absolutely not getting an invite to the cul-de-sac. Win or lose.
Somebody's plus one. Maybe we can be a plus one. Somebody could bring us.
They probably already got the cul-de-sac party already planned. They've already.
No matter what, every year they do the same celebration with or without the cup.
Put the flyers out there, you know.
Patrick Hamos says, sixth round picks don't matter. For every success story, there's 99 busts in that round. Probably more. Successes in late rounds are total outliers.
Okay, I'm going to say you're not a bust if you're picked in the sixth round, but you can get lightning in a bottle. We have numerous
times. We've got three players on our current roster, or three players that we've drafted. We've got two players on our current roster that are sixth round picks.
TJ, can I ask, are you just kind of laying down there in that chair now?
Just like,
you're not capable of sitting up?
Patrick had me going with he's saying we're going to win the Stanley Cup, and now all of a sudden he's telling me that sixth round picks don't matter, and I'm just on a difference of agreement. I don't know how I can manage this, Patrick. We're winning the cup, but sixth round picks matter. Matt Martin, fifth round pick. Yep.
Yeah.
Matt Molson was a ninth rounder. Yeah. Says CJ Scoots. Yep. Tom Brady was a sixth rounder. You know who else?
The People's Champion was a sixth rounder. Pick number 199.
200 other guys you never heard of. Okay, though, Patrick, look at the teams who draft well and find the guy in the sixth or seventh round. When they find the guy, when you find the Pavel Datsyuk, your team wins cups. When you find the guy who's an elite.
Zetterberg in the eighth round.
You win Stanley Cups.
That's right.
When you don't find guys like that, really tough. Because
if you don't have any picks, it's even tougher.
Exactly.
Almost impossible, might I say.
Paulo C. Grumpy.
Empire State, Boston is not the same team like 2 years ago or even last year. We got lucky to beat them 2 years ago. We absolutely did. If we play them, we will lose and fast too. True.
Yeah, think about this too. You
have Tuukka Rask
playing on a torn hip labrum. Simple as that.
They had no defensive depth.
No defensive depth either. Carla went out injured. Gungu says, TJ, besides consider being a sportscaster, how about voiceovers for commercials? Practice. For all of you, do.
Oh, no. It's for all of you. It's for all you do, this bud's for you.
Oh, for all you do, this bud's for you.
So that's a no for the commercial.
I can't read. I'm sorry, Goon. I can't read. Jesus. So we will.
Maybe they should put like a big spaces in between the words.
That would help.
For all you do.
Grumpy. Grumpy. Continuing right along here. Dan Drager says that Phillies in talks, taking calls on Ivan Provorov.
Why not? They probably didn't like that he sat out for the whatever.
One day. Max Power says Engvall mates Josh Bailey expendable. Wait, Josh Bailey's been expendable for about the last decade.
Do that.
Big trade rumor. Grumpy old man to trade TJ for D-cut. Grumpy.
No, not trading TJ. He's the Josh Bailey of this podcast. Never going anywhere.
CJ Scoots.
Yeah, I think he was a 2003 pick. So a while ago for sure. I don't know what he's talking about.
Yeah. Anders Lee. Great six-round pick. Was it Dobson or Romanoff who coughed up the puck that led to our goal last night? That was so bad. No, no. What happened was it was a coughed up puck. Sure. Where was our forward group? Where is our forward group on that? They not even at fucking mid ice. They're on the other fucking. They're cherry picking at the other team's blue line, and we're having to make a pass as he's getting pressure put on him from a system in his own zone. Or maybe he wasn't putting pressure on, but there was a change. He threw the puck towards the middle, and it flutters its way past the freaking faceoff dot, and Sorokin doesn't make a clean save, and Ryan Reeves bats the puck out of the air. I don't know what you want me to tell you. It's like saying, oh, because he made one bad play and 30 seconds later a goal went in, but the puck was out of the zone. It's a defenseman's fault. He cleared the puck out of the zone with goalie still give up the goal. I like Sorokin, but that's one he probably wanted to have better control over. They talked about it on the Wild interview. They said, man.
I thought yesterday Sorokin was...
He played well, but he coughed up a lot of rebounds.
I didn't think he was clean. I didn't think his game was clean last night.
Minnesota's announcer said he's played well, but he's giving up a lot of rebounds that he wants to control better. And they said that on the goal.
I love this comment. Sorry, I've got to cut you off, TJ. TJ, with that logic, then Anthony Beauvillier should have been a career bottom six forward, but he's put up a point of game season with Vancouver. Give Engvall a chance. Plus, there's are instances where he does. There you go. He's saying that Engvall coming to the Islanders is like Beauvillier lighting it up for Vancouver. Oh, my gosh.
Beauvillier played a top six role for us for, 85% of the games he was here? Engvall's never played a top six role for Toronto. Ever.
He's not a top six guy. He's a bottom six guy. Nothing wrong with that.
That's my point. Beauvillier has played in a top six role and had played in a top six role for us. For years and years and years, we just didn't make it work because the style we play was not conducive to him. Mm-hmm. Engvall's been a bottom six guy in Toronto, going to be a bottom six guy here. It's not like Engvall was a top six guy who's just flamed out a little bit. Different scenarios, but I'll give him a chance. He just would have been free on July 1st. Could have had him for nothing.
And we could have gotten him on July 1st.
He's got hands. I think he's got untapped potential. That's why he could be. That's why I say he's a deep in top six forward. God almighty. Top six! Grumpy man, come on. Romanoff is learning a new system while being a kid.
No. If you don't know how to play positionally at your age, you ain't never going to learn it.
Shay Grumpy.
It's not all about points, especially when you're defenseman. Romanoff has room to improve. Not saying that that Dobson doesn't, but he's consistently awful defensively. So is Romanoff.
Romanoff's worse.
Romanoff brings nothing to the table offensively. Nothing to the table offensively. He is a freaking zero offensively. He's a negative offensively. A zero. A negative number. He's an F minus offensively.
I need somebody like Phil's Fax to send me the Corsi numbers that people like to listen to because we can't just they like the little number stuff. I like what I've seen out of Dobson. He plays well defensively, better than you'd think. He
plays with shitty partners. Put him with Pellick. You're not going to be talking about Dobson defensively anymore.
Look at the defensive partners he's had in his NHL career. Johnny Boychuk.
Cash Green, Cash Chara, useless Romanoff, and
Sebastian Aho.
Aho. That's it.
Like, is that Robin Salo a few games? Samuel Bolduc for three games. He gets everybody they bring up. It's like, hey, roll your hand here with Noah Dobson. 3-4 games with a brand new partner. Another 4 games with a brand new partner. Samuel Bolduc. Hey, we're not going to pair you up with the most defensively sound guy. We're going to go ahead and put you on with Noah Dobson. Good luck. I hope you gel well in your three games together.
Yeah, they're just poor. Maybe they think he can spackle over the deficiencies in their games. I don't think he's that good.
I'm telling you, Grumpy. Shay says here, sure, he brings offense, which is good, but he's bad and plays out. His bad plays outweigh the good. Oh, wow.
Okay, I can't. You know, I wish we were doing live games because every time he makes a really solid play in his own end, which goes unnoticed or just they don't care, because he's not laying body checks. He goes and he shields guys away from the puck all the time. If a guy's coming in on him, he's got it. He's able to to move his body so he doesn't take the full brunt of the hit and makes plays out. He's the guy who moves the puck out of the zone. These other guys are not capable of it. Just not. Sorry.
Bama in overtime. Oh, my God. Johnny Mack. Auburn lost up 20. Oh. Fuck.
They were by 20 with 9 minutes to go.
John.
I wonder if that kid is still playing for Alabama.
Yeah, of course he is.
He's like they're making boatloads of excuses for him.
Frank says here, finally, Pelican Pulak played three good games. Played their good defensively. Yep, Varlamov and Mayfield are not going to move to Lewis standing pat, says Drew S. Yep. And here we go. I'm in Toronto. I want to go out for drinks with Phil's Facts, says Chris Stearman.
Pretty be a pretty boring date.
Max Power said Phil's great, but I love when Andy's on. That guy kills me. LOL. We love them all too. Patrick Hamo says, we're getting the real answers tonight. I don't know what that is, but fair enough.
We're giving the real answers.
And Nick G says here, how do you rank the Rangers deal? Was that worth it for Kane?
Absolutely.
I don't think the Rangers needed more offensive firepower. Their defense is the weakest portion of their game. But, hey, like the same thing. It's a good value trade. But, man, they needed other things, in my opinion. They still have time, but they need other things.
They're hard trying to out offense. The rest of the league's not going to work.
Frank says here, told my daughter how the guys will be smashing in the corner in front of us. She's getting excited about the game too. Good for you, Frank. You're going to have to let us know how it goes on Saturday on your way back relaxing because it's the matinee game. Let us know how that game goes.
Yeah.
Andrew L says, might want to rephrase the comment there. Oh, rephrase that comment there, Frank. Oh, gosh. Man, we are about, we're far in here, Grumpy. Oh, fire TJ, hire Lou. So the grumpy old man and the delusional grumpy old man.
Wow,
I like that one. I like that one. Which one's the delusional grumpy old man?
Man, I bet you we get into a fight every single podcast. I'd have to attack him. When he tries to give me coach speak, I said, this is not a coach speak show, sunshine.
Oh, God almighty, Grump.
You're not getting away with that here.
Declan says here, adding my previous point, Durando was just sent down. Has Koivula really looked better than him? I don't think Koivula really has. I liked Otto Koivula, and I just kind of like to just joke around about how I wish he was still there. But, I mean, I like Durando more out of what I saw in Koivula. Sure.
They got Engvall now. They got Engvall. They don't need anybody else.
That's true.
They can only play with eight forwards. Engvall everywhere, up and down the lineup.
The rumor was that Jean-Gabriel Peugeot may be concussed, so he's available the first game back against, I think, Detroit this Saturday. Angel said here, Holmstrom, Koivula, and Durando have all been sent down.
Holmstrom sucks. That's a good thing to do. Koivula, he's not much better. Durando, I like.
Prince Chicken Wing says here, it could be to keep them fresh. Bridgeport plays tomorrow. The Islanders don't play till Saturday. That's also true. Viniel said, this is not 94. The Rangers can't buy a cup any longer.
Ooh.
They're never going to trade away Josh Bailey. Yep. What's sharper? Phil's facts destroying the Islanders community with his sharp facts or Holmstrom's chin that could chisel a swan sculpture out of ice?
I don't know.
I don't know. But hey.
Holmstrom's not good for anything. Neither is Phil, really. But, you know, at least I like Phil. So.
Oh, good gracious, man. We're here at the end of the show, man. We're here. We did that 3.5 hours. Thank you, everybody. Sorry we did not get through all of the comments tonight. We do apologize. We're doing our best trying to get through all the comments. We are. Do you like Linkin Park? Yes, Synergy HD. Of course we do. I like it. But, man, we are here at the end of the show. We'll look through. Oh, CJ Lupin Power Rangers alive. Okay, we're good. We're good. We're good. He's alive. He's good. He's alive and well.
We're worried about you.
Lou trading for Engvall. Just like Lou helping for the Leafs free up cap space, waste of cap space. We need a top six scoring winger, not a fourth liner. Who's a fucking idiot? Yes, I think that Jean-Gabriel Peugeot was concussed, I think was the rumor on it, but he might be back. Who the heck knows? Anyway, I'm sorry. Oh, I got one of these Trey Barzal. He's not worth the $9 million we're going to pay him. Okay. Anyway. Grumpy, we're here at the end of the show, 3.5 hours in. Sorry we didn't get to every comment, but we're trying our best. We'll read them all afterwards, as we always do. But Grumpy, what do you want to say before we wrap things up?
I want to say love and laughter to everyone who listens, and even those who don't, from TJ and the Grumpy Old Man.
Thank you, Bree, for listening to the show.
And listen to the TJ and Grumpy Old Man show tomorrow.
Yes. Number one, I forgot to mention this. We're 3.5 hours in. Leave a thumbs up. Apparently, it helps the algorithm. This is going to help the algorithm a whole lot, letting people know 3.5 hours in. But it helps the algorithm. Woohoo! Give us a 5-star on Apple or one of those little podcast rating things, whatever. Apparently, it helps the algorithm. I don't know. But thank you so much, everybody, for watching and listening to tonight's show. We'll be going live with you guys tomorrow on TJ and the Grumpy Old Man. That's a can't miss because, hell, there probably will be more NHL trades for us to talk about over tomorrow's show. So make sure you're there. You don't want to miss out on any of the action. But we'll be live with you this next Saturday, unless Lou does something fucking nuts on Friday, which I don't anticipate he will. But we'll be with you guys also live this Saturday, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Thank you so much, everybody, for watching the show. Thank you so much, Grumpy. Hey, it's Wednesday, hump day, halfway through the week.
Is it?
Hey, yeah, I know you don't have to worry about that stuff, but it's hump day, Grumpy. Sorry again, we couldn't get through all the comments, but we're trying to improve. We're trying to get better. I don't know. It's just a lot of comments here. We want to try to make sure we get through all of them. We will read over all of them, but thank you so much, everybody, for commenting in, sharing your opinions, sharing your thoughts, and thank you again, as always, Grumpy.
My pleasure.